Welcome to We Are Libertarians for this week. I am your host, Chris Spangle. To my right is Greg Lenz.
Chris, how are you, buddy?
To the fascist right.
The fascist right. The hostile right.
As he storms his way through the Libertarian Party in Indiana. And across the table is the birthday boy, Mr. Harry Price. How are you, Harry?
I'm going great. I got this BG Java going through my veins right now. It feels good. I like coffee and beer, especially when it's mixed together, and it's awesome for my birthday.
Coffee and alcohol mixed together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This doesn't seem good for you.
No, it's awesome. it's going to be great. I came up with the...
great.
Yeah. I like the idea of coffee and beer because I grew up watching the Drew Carey show, so like they kept making Buzz Beer, kept talking about it. I was like, man, when I get older, I want coffee and beer.
Oh, man.
Well, we have had... I'm exhausted.
And I am pooped.
And it's Thursday. We still have several days of festivities ahead of us. Yesterday we went to the Trump rally. Today we're recording the podcast. Tomorrow, and after this, I'm going to see Emily. She's doing a comedy show. And then tomorrow starts the Libertarian Party of Indiana convention. Saturday, the convention. Sunday, I'm going to rest. And then Monday is our live show. First ever We Are Libertarians live show on the 25th at 7:15 at Morty's Comedy Joint. Tickets are on sale now. Listen, they only seat like 200 or 300 people. So you need to go to the Morty's website and buy your tickets now.
It looks like it's going to be booked.
It's going to be a sellout. I expect a sellout.
Do okay? you?
I expect a sellout.
Oh, yeah. Standing room
Harry,
only.
Harry, you expect a sellout,
standing room only.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
All right. Yeah, me too.
Yeah, so go to the Morty's
website. We got these posters.
Get your tickets now. Yes. And thanks to Jason Doolittle of Texas. We got a message at the We Are Libertarians page. If you want to get in touch with us, you can send us a message at the page. And if you open your Messenger app now... They changed Facebook Messenger. You open the app, you type in We Are Libertarians, you can send us a message directly.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah, so...
Oh, that's why Aaron Ewert's been sending so many messages to the page.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because he is Aaron.
I guess. And I've been quite hostile towards him.
I know. So were you the one who told me to F myself?
I did.
Okay.
I was so much fun. So I was like, this is great. I know Spangle's busy with something because otherwise he'd never be messaging the page. So I think what I'll do is I'll just troll back. Well, you and Aaron were doing it at the same time.
I wasn't trolling. I was just testing out the new feature to see what it did. And then like I'm like, hi. And then I get a message. F you, F. So, yeah.
That's how much we appreciate our listeners.
Yeah.
That's the auto response.
The auto response is go F yourself, you dirty animal. So we got a message from Jason Doolittle, and Jason said, listen, I live in Texas, I'm a huge fan of the show, and I was going to fly up to Indianapolis to see the show, but I can't make it, so can I donate? And we said, yeah. And so we took that money. I designed a really cool poster. You guys got a couple copies.
Yeah, for $2. Yes.
Yeah, yes. Harry, you owe me $2. Yep.
In the mail. You gotta wait till the first of the month.
I'm giving you a deal. I'm only making you cover the cost of the posters. Mm-hmm. So, happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
You get it at warehouse prices. We're bootstrapping here. It's a small business. We gotta run lean. So everybody pulls their weight. Now, these cool posters are free to anybody. Unlike Harry, they're free for anybody that comes Monday night. So you're going to get a free poster. I've got plenty for everybody.
We're going to sign them.
I mean, if you want us to sign it, then I'll
sign it. No, we're not giving you a choice. We're signing our posters.
Like, if you want us to ruin it, we'll sign it. But, yeah, so everybody who comes gets a really cool 11x17 poster. You can go to Target and get yourself a $15 frame. It looks amazing. You can see a version up there up on the wall of the old logo. It is the perfect fashion statement for your man cave or your garage or whatever. So show up, get yourself a free poster, see the live show. Joe Ruiz, our good friend, is going to be our co-host that day. Driving down from South Bend for the live show. He's come up with a couple games, so expect dad jokes.
What a trooper.
Yeah. So I mean, he doesn't have the commitment that Jason does, but
yeah, you know, but still, that's yeah. And especially with Joe, you know, that's a big commitment for Joe, and we appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely, because he's got like he's the only one that's married and has kids. I mean, you're basically married, Harry.
Yeah, basically, but you know.
You don't have.
He has like full control over his schedule, though.
Yeah, right.
It's kind of weird.
Yeah.
Well, it's because he's not married. He's smart.
That's true.
Yeah.
The second you say I do, Harry would become property of his girlfriend.
Exactly. That's why you just gotta cohabitate. You know, this way you can instantly pull out at any time, as needed. You know, just like it's prom night.
Was that a euphemism or?
Yeah, just like prom night. You just pull out and you get ready to go.
You know, really, being an anarchist is the greatest thing ever for a guy, because you can be like, listen, I'm sorry, but it would violate my personal philosophy to have the state between you and I.
Sometimes I think she's more of an anarchist than I am, though.
Especially what's that say about you?
I don't know. Like, well, she when we're at Porkfest, you know, before she was like, oh, no. But now, after she goes there, she knows more people than I do there. And she gets in this huge, like, philosophical discussion about this, you know, why the state's irrelevant. I'm like, wow, where'd that come from? You know, it used to be someone I'm just tugging along and bringing up to New Hampshire. Now it's like, woo, yeah, I'm down with this.
That's great.
Yeah, he's going to be a free stater.
I went to Emily's family's house last night, and Emily doesn't care about politics at all. Like,
no.
I'm lucky because Emily's 20, but like what most 20-year-olds, unless they're nerds like us, don't care about politics. And she, did I mention I have a 20-year-old girlfriend?
How old is she?
20.
20. Okay.
Brett's not here, so I had to do it for him.
Yeah.
So he's usually the one busting my balls about that.
He was supposed to be here at 6. He'll be here at his own pace, 8:30 tomorrow.
Right. Yeah. So they're all Marco Rubio Republicans.
Mm-hmm.
The whole family, they all love politics. They love to talk politics. The only one that doesn't is Emily.
Mm-hmm.
But Emily loves listening to me talk about politics. She doesn't understand it. She doesn't care. But she loves when I say things like economy and delegate.
Mm.
Big fan. So, fortunately, I've hit the jackpot.
You really have.
So, it's not like the old regime. In the old regime, if I was trying to talk about things that I cared about, we had to switch a topic to the topic of whatever she cared about.
Whatever was in Touch magazine.
Right. Yeah. It's, you know, or whatever awful thing a hairstylist did that day. And I was like, oh, wow, no. Really? That's terrible. And so I went over there last night.
Back to chat.
We just started, yeah, exactly right. Chat was one of the things that ruined my marriage,
it
because
did.
I was like, oh, my friends are so much more interesting than my wife.
We do have some dank memes, though.
Oh, yes. We weren't even on the memes back then.
No, we were mainly, we were miming.
This is 2013, but memes got introduced later in 2013, and then it was just all over. Hey, Mittens, we're trying to record this on the screen. You jackass.
Needs more Greg Lenz.
No. I told you that cat's racist, Harry.
Yeah.
I'm serious, Mittens. You need to stop the racism. It's not cool. It's Harry's birthday. Could you knock it off, God. Mittens Wallace? It's
boy.
George Wallace over here.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
sorry, you're already...
I'm triggered.
Lunch. Yeah.
No.
At the convention, yeah. Never should have gotten back involved in politics.
I tried to warn him.
Mm-hmm.
So the countdown to the convention is being kind of stressful.
Yeah. So anytime you get to convention season and you have contested races, it's like election season, you pick a side and then you start arguing against the other side. And eventually it turns hostile and terrible and everybody wants to quit by the end of it. And that's happened, so we got someone threatened to sue us over a campaign person from the other campaign because Greg dared to post four articles that are the four articles at the top of Google, and that was like because he pointed out facts reported by news agencies about a public political figure and he wrote a piece about it.
Mm-hmm.
That meant that we are libertarians should be sued for slander and libel or whatever it is. It's like,
well, the person that sued us, she got her
tried
partial. Yeah. She went to some law classes at a like strip mall law school.
Yeah,
you know, one of those for-profit ones. I think she, I don't know,
Kaplan or
allegedly.
One of the other ones.
Yeah,
like,
DeVry Law.
Yeah,
stop it. That's not true, is it?
Yeah.
Oh.
Oh no, that might be defamation.
Break off.
Oh, I'm not worried. I'll be fine.
Harry showed up and like we were like, oh, by the way, you got to contribute to the legal fund.
Yeah. That's what Harry. No.
At $2.
This is all. I mean, no, it's totally fine. Everything's gonna be just fine. And the convention will go well. But yeah, it's been exhausting. It hasn't been for me. What's actually been exhausting for me is keeping it in. When I get it out, I feel great and relaxed. I've been having to swallow a lot of what I wanted to say for a long time, and so now I don't feel that need anymore, and that feels pretty good.
Yeah.
I'm actually looking quite forward to the in-person interactions.
Nice, yeah. Where they can't hide behind like some chat wall or something and log off.
Well, there's just a lot of people that don't approach me for whatever reason, and they go to Chris.
Mm-hmm. It's exhausting for me because for whatever reason, libertarians are incredibly sensitive, hypersensitive about any kind of criticism within the party. And they never go directly to the person, they go to the person's friend and say, "Why are you doing this?" And I go, "I'm not Greg. I don't necessarily agree with what he wrote. That's what he wrote. And we build a platform together, and he's free to say what he wants. I'm not going to control him." That's not
it wasn't
job.
A lie.
No, it's not a lie. Yeah. It's not the tactic that I'm going to take.
No. Jesus probably wouldn't have gone that route.
No.
But, I can only aspire to be like him, not.
It was non-violence, telling the truth. You don't know. Jesus probably would have memed.
Oh, well, all in all, it is exhausting. Now, politics is exhausting because of the egos. I mean, it's incredible to watch the inner goings of a political party. No wonder everyone hates each other by the end of their careers in politics.
Yeah.
And, like, the camps are so small, like, the teams are so small and so loyal. You know, and you're totally immune to facts and evidence because you've just been through so many battles together where, like, eventually you just say to hell all the facts. Like, these are just my people and that's just the way it's going to be, and I'll be damned if the sky is not green.
Now you know why post-divorce the first year I was not divorced, but I was in a different job. The chair that took over I didn't quite agree with, so I wanted to give him space and I needed a break because I was burned out. And then the next 2 years I got divorced. I mean, you just cannot be involved in this kind of stuff when you're going through personal turmoil. So you see the emotion that it takes to go through the political process.
But yeah, I mean, it just zaps you for the rest of your life. That little bit of energy you have to go through the motions. Yep. You know, because Harry, have you ever been involved like in a political campaign within the LP?
No.
What about the GOP?
No, I stayed away from most of the campaign stuff. I did, like, donate and help volunteer for certain GOP campaigns, mostly just take down Carson. But, I try to stay out of it, other than that, because I understand, I play a lot of different political LARP games, and I understand, like, the political moves. It's fun doing all this backstabbing stuff like that, but I appreciated being able to, when the game ended, I could still chum up with my friends. Watching you guys actually do this in real life, I was like, wow, these are the same moves, the same techniques I would do in my game, but this is for real.
But there's no emotion necessarily attached to it in the game?
Yeah, there's no emotion attached to it in the game. It's like, haha, we'll laugh it up at IHOP later.
Yeah, well, it's sort of what's happening, and this isn't exclusive to the Libertarian Party, I want to be clear.
No, it's way worse than the other parties.
Yeah, because there's more money there.
And the crying, though, is worse than the Libertarian Party, because they've never experienced this on a consistent basis.
This is now that I'm 32, I see younger coworkers, friends, who are experiencing stuff for the first time that I thought was really big and really traumatizing, really scary. And then I have experienced it like 3 more times. I'm like, oh, whatever. Because once you go through something once, then you realize like, oh, this is the first time I'm feeling all this. It's really terrible. And that's kind of what's happening in the Libertarian Party of Indiana. Mm. We have multiple contested races, starting with the gubernatorial race, some congressional races. Yeah. So, and in the presidential race too. And so the Libertarian Party, because it's growing, is now going through growing pains and dealing with contested races for the first time. And so it feels really tough because this is the first time contested races have ever happened. But, I'll tell you, I mean, in 2012, what people don't realize in 2012, I've been accused of being puritanical and trying to keep, like, Republicans and Democrats, especially Republicans, from joining the party. Anybody who listens to the show knows that I'm consistently telling Republicans flee. And you guys have been awesome in sending notes to us about how We Are Libertarians has helped you in your journey to libertarianism and any political party, because we're a nonpartisan podcast. Like, I'm a Libertarian Party person. Greg is a Republican, although a Libertarian Party member now.
Yeah, we'll see how long they let me stay. I may have to go back. I'll be the first ever deported member of the LP.
You know, and people
deport
have
you, McAfee, Joe.
And we've been posting some of this on the We Are Libertarians Facebook page. Some of the notes that you guys have sent saying, "Hey, I'm a libertarian because of you guys," which is really flattering. And you know, in addition to contributions financially at WeAreLibertarians.com via PayPal or Patreon, these notes saying, "Hey, you guys made a difference in my thinking, in my life," or, you know, it just is very flattering and makes us work even harder, as you can tell by your podcast feed in the next few days. So there's just a lot of, so what has happened in 2012? Rupert ran for governor.
Rupert Bonham. He was a survivor.
Survivor, big beard, bushy bearded guy, great human being, lives the libertarian lifestyle, but not necessarily a Libertarian Party philosopher like our
friend. He didn't know it yet.
Right.
Like, you know, he was living the life, but he had no idea that's what his lifestyle was.
He had joined the party and had spent a year in the party helping fundraise, getting to know people before he decided to run for governor. And, you know, he was not... in the eyes of a lot of libertarians, he was a bad candidate. But the thing that libertarians didn't understand is that we didn't run Rupert for libertarians. Because you can't run races for libertarians.
You'll have 243 votes.
Right, because you'll get the same...
As long as no one has car trouble.
Right, you'll get the same 1% that you always do.
Because you rode in the same car?
Mm-hmm.
And so Rupert, as Rupert went across the country, literally across the country to Vegas to the national convention, but across the state, you'd see people that never would think about voting for a libertarian coming in and taking the quiz, talking to him about solutions. Rupert talked about issues that libertarians didn't dwell on, that we were just starting to talk about, like pot legalization, criminal justice reform, juvenile offender programs, vocational training, things that were really impactful for the lower rungs of the socioeconomic ladder.
Right.
And so many people wrote into Rupert and came up to Rupert and after the campaign wrote in and said, "You're the first candidate to talk about my issues." And that's what Rupert was about. Rupert was about reaching out to non-libertarians, and libertarians didn't get that. And so they spent all of 2012 absolutely savaging me, the campaign, Rupert, Evan, his campaign manager. And so, you know, what would happen is, you know, it's like when I was a kid. We'd be in the back seat on the way to Florida. My brother would just be poking, and trying to get a reaction from my sister and I. And as soon as one of us would react and hit her, "He hit me!" And so in 2012, I, because I worked for the party and collected a paycheck, had to sit there and take that poking, to the point that one person was saying that I was embezzling from the party.
Yeah.
You know, and it just...
That's like... Why is that the libertarian criticism of anyone in power? Like, I had this same conversation currently about our friend of ours.
Right.
That every time I hear, like, libertarians want to take somebody down, it's embezzling party funds. What funds?
There's no money. Yeah. There isn't money. Like, you know...
Like, what funds are you stealing? Is it Bitcoin?
Embezzlement would have been taking a $10 bill out of the collection plate.
It's the Ron Paul t-shirt treasure.
Apparently.
Okay.
Right. Honestly.
Got all the bumper stickers.
And so a lot of that has happened this time, and there's poking, trying to diminish my influence, diminish what my point of view, using things that Greg and others have said that are a little more harsh than I would say, but not necessarily wrong.
Well, I don't know about that. I just put it into picture format what you had already said.
That is true. There was an incident where we made a meme about...
You said it. I just turned it into a meme.
So there's a joke that we have with a high school
good friend of ours.
Yeah. And we were having an argument about the U.S. candidate, Todd Young, here in the state. And I was just saying that he was making a mockery of his military service by making it a political punchline.
Well, he's never been in the military either.
Who, Adam?
Mm-hmm.
Well, it doesn't matter, but he was trying to use the cheap point of, "Have you ever been in the military?" So I knew what he was doing, and I know him, so
triggered.
I just replied with the standard joke of, I spent my early 20s in the service of invading your mother repeatedly.
Liberating her, if you will.
And he replied, well, that's funny because my mom died in a plane crash in the late 80s. Which is, I didn't know that at all. And so we had a...
But he felt bad.
I didn't feel bad. I said, oh, I didn't know that. I'm sorry. I apologize. And so he made a joke about it, so I just replied, get your mom some cocoa butter because she's a little ashy. And so, so it came down to it. I said, listen, I'm sorry. If you want, you can come fight me at our live show. You get a free... I'll give you a free ticket to come and we'll wrestle or something. And so,
actually, you did leverage it to get him to show up for the live show.
Absolutely.
You totally did. It was beautiful.
I'm a marketing genius. I'm the Donald Trump of the Libertarian movement.
There you go.
And so Greg made a meme of me as a scumbag, nervous about attendance, makes fun of people for fucking their dead mother. And this meme got taken across the web, across the Facebook, amongst the other side of the aisles, so to speak, as juvenile, which of course it's juvenile. We know that, you dummies.
But the person said that we were referencing their mother. Their mother's alive and comments on their Facebook stuff all the time.
Right, which is
so
hilarious.
I know this, and so I'm like, no, you've triggered me. And I'm the worst person to trigger.
There's just a lot of...
Because as bad as you think it's going to be 10 times worse.
Right. Yes. So it's... But there's poking. And finally this week, Greg and I have just had it. Because now they're starting to attack Greg, and we are libertarians, and myself.
And I love this stuff. So, like, that's so stupid. I love to make people uncomfortable and to get angry and loud and yell.
I hate it so much. I'm so uncomfortable, and I hate every moment of it. But I'm right. So you just get through it. You just go, listen... You know, if you're going to come after my future business, and you're going to come after me, and you're going to come after my friends, and you're going to threaten our growth, and you're going to say it publicly, I'm going to have to respond, and you're going to have to deal with it. And I'm tired of people not having the backstory coming at us and saying, oh, it's infighting, it's immature, your memes, it's destructive to the party. And I go, well, listen, here's the thing, okay?
Oh boy.
Funny internet pictures are juvenile. And you know what? We made a conscious choice when we started this podcast to be a little irreverent. What is our slogan? Anybody know?
All of the irreverence modern politics deserves.
Right. Because how do people respond to the libertarian message? Through stuffy, boring lectures from a middle-aged white male.
People know Ron Paul. They don't know Murray Rothbard.
You gotta understand that you have to read a little bit more about you.
Right.
They love to quote Hayek.
Right.
And they're offended if it's a cultural reference that demonstrates the same point that's widely known.
I have spent my
bow ties and
I have spent my entire life immersed in radio, trying to figure out the best way to build a radio program that communicates big ideas simply. That is what I love to do. I'm a communications person. It turns me on. It makes me so warm inside. And the best podcasts, because I've been a huge fan of podcasts for more than 10 years, are podcasts like this. You know?
Yeah.
The best part of Bob and Tom...
Not ours, but ones that mimic a similar fashion.
Yeah. The best part of Glenn Beck is when it's him and his buddies joking with each other. Mm-hmm. The best part of Bob and Tom or Howard Stern are when they're not talking to a guest... where they're not lecturing, they're ragging on each other, you know? And so what we do here is we talk with each other, we have fun with each other, we just kick back, relax, drink, make jokes, and we let you sit back in your living room as if you're sitting in our living room, and you get to eavesdrop on the conversation that friends have. And that extends to Facebook sometimes. And yes, sometimes it is out of respectability, it's out of the realm of political respectability. But you know what the problem with politics is? It's that people don't look at politics and see their life in it. They don't see vulnerability. They don't see any kind of authenticity. They don't see the same rules applied to their life. And I'm sorry, this party, this political podcast does not speak for the Libertarian Party of Indiana, of the National Party, the Republican Party.
I don't want them to dare associate with us. I listen to their messages.
I don't want, and if you were so, I don't think people are obtuse enough to know, to like associate, to think that Greg and I are the same person, but they seem to be missing that point. They seem to be thinking that we are the spokespeople for the Libertarian Party. And yes, we are influential. Yes, we have 4,000 listeners. Yes, we have dozens of people that write us and say, I'm a libertarian, I've joined the Libertarian Party because of your podcast. because of what you guys do. Mm-hmm. I have fun, I enjoy it, I share it with my friends, and it's because we're irreverent. And I've made a big mistake, and I'd like to apologize to our listeners, and to Greg, and to Harry, and to anybody, and to the Libertarian Party of Indiana. I didn't learn from Wayne Allyn Root. Wayne Allyn Root is not somebody that I always agreed with, but Wayne Allyn Root was a media figure who did commentary, who went on Fox News, who wrote articles, who did a lot of media work and marketing, and was responsible for a lot of people hearing the word libertarian for the first time. But Wayne also was on the National Libertarian Committee, and you might want to see and make sure that the cat's not tearing up your poster.
Oh, she is.
Cornelius, that'll be $2. And so Wayne, because he, inside the political party, had a group of people that weren't on his side. They get it?
It's all right. This one's signed by Cornelius.
It'll be fine.
It's
very, like, tiny.
And so... So Wayne, his opponents politically used his statements and used his presence as a media commentator against his associates, the people that he supported, and him personally. So you can't have your feet in both camps. You can't do what we do. You can't do commentary. You can't go and observe. You can't and be an activist inside of a political party or in leadership, because What had happened is that we support a certain candidate, and because of our style, it is hurting the party and it is hurting our candidate. And let me just say, because I know you're listening, I know you download it, and I know you listen every week, and then you share it in your little groups and you talk with each other, and then you take it down to the club and you share it with your friends there. So transcribe this and put this up on the bulletin board. We don't do this for a political party to grow a political party. I don't care about a political party. I love the Libertarian Party. It is who I vote for the majority of the time. It is, I spent many, many, many years of hard work building the leadership tree for $24,000 a year with a thankless ass attitude from libertarians who are doing exactly what you're doing.
So they could participate in governor's debates so outside parties could come in and exploit it.
Right. Yep. And so yep. I love the Libertarian Party, and I love the people that I'm going to see this weekend, and it has always been enjoyable for the most part, except for when this kind of bull happens. So I'll make you a promise. After this weekend, I probably won't show up anymore, if that's what the majority of you want. Because I don't want what we do, which is bringing in a new wave of people who have never been associated with any political party or who mildly believe what we believe, we'll just tell them to be nonpartisan. Support the candidate that you like, not the party that you like. And that's about where I'm at, frankly.
That's kind of where I've always been, Harry.
Yeah. Me, personally, it's like, I don't like governments. I vote for the Libertarian Party because, well, I vote for third party candidates just to allow them ballot access. That's the only reason I vote. I think voting is dumb, stupid, can't believe people are still doing it. But that's my own personal belief, but I will still vote for the Libertarian Party sometimes just for the simple fact that message gets out there.
Yeah.
But if they're going to be this toxic like that, then, you know.
It frankly, it's hurtful.
Yeah.
It's hurtful to me because these are people that I've spent a lot of time with, put a lot of sweat equity.
They're friends first, usually.
I ruined my fucking marriage for that job. I mean, and nobody asked me to do that, but that's just the function of the job. I deeply care about the party and having third parties and having a platform for libertarians to run for office. But when you don't give me the benefit of the doubt and you just buy into the motherfucking the whole time and you don't come and talk to me, God bless Andy Horning. Andy Horning has always been a friend and will always be a friend. Andy is one of the few people that has come to me and said, I don't like this. And and I've just explained to him, like, here's what we're doing, here's what's been happening, and here's the context. You know, he didn't run around and it's personally hurtful when people, like, because if you go out and you start talking about people, it gets back to them. You know? And, like, you figure out where people stand. And so it's not, it just be at a certain point in the process, it becomes personal. And it stops being about the business, it stops being about the politics, and it starts to become personal. And you know what, I will walk into that convention hall, and I'll be able to walk up to Jim Wallace and shake him in the hand and know that I did everything in a way that I'm proud of. And I have explained time and time again that I don't think he's a good candidate, and that I don't think he's the right fit for our party. And having that opinion has meant the threat of lawsuit, the loss of many, many hours trying to calm people down, you know. So I'm sorry. Like,
you're tending to the feels,
right? Yeah. Like, there's one specific person that was on last year that I can't honestly tell you a person that's in the party because of them, and I can't tell you anybody that they've brought into the party, but that is the person that the majority of the people have listened to instead of the person that helped build the leadership tree and has worked continuously for 8 years now building the Libertarian Party and the message, you know. And the fruits of your labor go out the window when you try to do something different and outside of the box.
Yep.
And that's the problem with political parties, and that's why political parties aren't going to exist. Because the problem is, it isn't an attack on the Libertarian Party. If I were in the Republican Party, I'd be going through the same thing. Just like our buddy Rob Kendall goes through.
Just like we're seeing at the national presidential. We saw it yesterday with Rob.
Yep.
Rob is as nice a guy as you're probably ever going to meet.
Absolutely.
Like, he is as good a person and as good an outgoing and fun of guy as you'll be around. And the fact that the way the Indiana GOP treats him, when he is the one that's been the Trump fan forever,
mm-hmm.
Trump fanboy, he goes and he gets treated poorly by a member of Mike Pence's staff for a little other reason than being an outspoken critic of the absurd and counterproductive policies that Mike Pence has supported and passed and spearheaded.
Yeah.
He knows it. He's doing it to score political points with the base and position himself for a long-term presidential run.
Mm-hmm.
But Rob isn't Rob will, he's like me. He will say when he thinks you're wrong. And if you come after him, he'll say it louder.
Yep.
But there's nothing wrong with that. And I will be the first to admit if I've made a mistake or I've said something wrong, and Rob's the same way. But every political party is the same way in that eventually facts don't matter. Loyalty's all that exists.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it really does seem like the facts don't matter to these people. Like, it seems like, is it the same group of people that didn't like Rupert?
No, these are people that are newer to the party. They weren't around when
the Republicans that could never get access.
Okay, right. So they went, you know, so the sore losers who jumped ship, who moved over to the other ship.
They're here to save everybody.
Yeah. Okay, well, okay, so I went and looked at, actually dug at the election results of the 2012 election. I actually went through the Excel sheet, started looking at count, because everyone kept talking about, to me personally, honest, I don't care what anyone does, Pence is going to win. The counties that Pence won, he's going to win again. Where Pence lost, he's going to lose again to John Gregg. And someone like a Rex Bell is going to upset the counties where Mike Pence won in.
Yeah.
Wallace, he went to Harvard, so what? So he's a New Englander coming here over to the Midwest trying to win. Those people outside the donut are not going to respond to that.
Well, here's the thing. Wallace has an impressive biography and is a well-spoken person, but he's Republican light. I mean, he's a guy that was begging to be Pence's running mate in December and then decided that he couldn't get access. He couldn't get
a meeting,
and so he threatened to run with us,
mm-hmm.
and so he did,
mm-hmm.
and then he got pot committed.
And I personally asked their campaign about that privately, and I said, "Is this true?"
Mm-hmm.
Well, it is what it is. Okay, you know, I mean, so it just shows you that, like, we're being used as a vendetta by somebody who has...
There's no reason. There's no way to attack Rex Bell because he's got exceptional character.
Mm-hmm.
He is as trustworthy, honest, and competent as anyone you'll ever encounter in any realm of your life. There's no way to attack the guy. So what do they do? Is they say, oh, well, the Libertarian Party isn't crazy about the antics of Chris and Greg and people associated Harry and people associated with Wall. So that's our one thing we can identify and try to use as a wedge issue to create dissent among the delegates.
Somehow we've become unwelcome.
I had no interest in ever being in the party. I you know, like, that was my thing. Is like, I met Rex, and then I was like, you know what? Rex is the kind of guy that I would join a party for. I'd shake, yeah. You shake Rex's hand, and I never have to Google to verify.
Yeah.
I shake Rex's hand, and I know that no matter what he tells me, I don't ever have to worry about a bill getting passed. Because, you know, being governor isn't about competency. It really isn't. You know, I'm a firm believer that the more difficult the job, the more rudimentary the training is for it. And it's entirely about character. Because character, when you're in a leadership position, tells you whether you have to worry about if someone's going to pass a bill that says you have to get what do they call that? What Pence just passed with the abortion bill.
Embarrassment.
Well, yeah, I mean, you have to suffer public embarrassment by going and having sonography, or where they show you a picture of the
ultrasound.
Baby.
Yeah, ultrasound. Yeah.
Sorry, I had a brain fart. But like, that's what character tells you. A guy like Rex Bell, what he tells you when he runs a campaign is exactly what he will do every day in office, whether you're asleep, whether you're awake, whether you're paying attention, whether anyone else is paying attention. And that's what separates him from every other candidate in the race.
And that's exactly the Republican and the Democrat that he's running against aspire to be Rex Bell. Like, their campaign is authentic Hoosier. Rex is an authentic Hoosier. Rex is the type of guy that people trust instantly, and he's an authentic person. Mm-hmm. And
he likes people. That's the big difference between him and the other candidates.
Right.
He doesn't see them as tools or voters.
Right. And so when
driving out in the fake pickup truck, I drive this truck every day. Yes, you
right.
do. Yeah.
And this election cycle is about a message that people haven't heard, something that is different from a messenger that is trustworthy and authentic. And that is Rex Bell. And that is why he is our best chance to run against John Gregg and Mike Pence. Mm-hmm. And not somebody who is not trustworthy, who doesn't come across authentic, and just is basically a different version of Mike Pence. He likes gays.
He doesn't hate gays as much.
Right. And there are a group of people who just want their country club libertarians.
They want to be able to go to dinner parties and not and say, oh, well, our candidate is actually has a place on Geist, and he actually was a former Republican. He went to Harvard.
Right.
Yeah.
And it doesn't matter, because if Mike Pence is going to win, it's a culture war.
Yep.
He has to force John Gregg to own the gays.
Mm-hmm.
If he forces John Gregg to own the gays, the FDR Democrat coalition that supports Gregg evaporates, and Rex Bell's the only one that appeals to him.
Yeah.
I've looked at politics forever, follow races deeply. Paul polls daily, and I'm telling you, there is no chance of trying to find these mythical Republicans that are somehow less socially conservative than the typical Mike Pence base that will jump ship in a close election for a Libertarian candidate.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that will are disaffected Democrats that are mad their candidate all of a sudden is walking in pride parades.
Right. And they're likely to be progressive people who are not going to vote for somebody with two domestic violence arrests.
I'm not even gonna go. Yeah, because that's just a non-starter.
It's not like they were tossed out. He got two diversions, which means he wasn't
acknowledged the truthfulness of the charges pressed against him.
Yes.
Yeah.
And so, when the argument becomes one of you're embarrassing the party because of a meme. Shut up so we can nominate the guy who has two diversions for domestic violence. I sit there and just start going, what the fuck is wrong with all of you?
How fragile is their case? How fragile is their party that a meme can stop you?
Like, you understand.
You wouldn't believe because he has Trump conversations about people that don't want to be memed.
Yeah. Trump gets memed all the time. Trump just battles on. That's nice. So
he grows stronger.
Right. Mike Pence gets phone calls about women on their periods. Trump was on. Whatever, I'm running. This is what I'm doing.
And I respect the hell out of that.
But yeah. that's
Pencilship,
the
whatever. Own it. Keep going.
Like, you think that a blog post from a libertarian website pointing out the top four articles on Google are worthy of suing? Are you kidding me? You're not ready for prime time.
Yep.
You're not ready to go up against John Gregg and Mike Pence, who have unlimited resources. We have a website that, like, is we have no money.
It's an afterthought. Like, we've never been a podcast first, and our website's where we go to,
hobby.
Yeah, and like, and so
you're not ready to handle John Gregg. John Gregg is the guy that sent people after Rupert, because after the election, the LGBT progressives, the unions, and the Democratic Party blamed Rupert for the loss. And if you think for one second the promise of that candidate who says that he has talked to the other two parties and they promise not to bring it up, what kind of delusional person is that?
Yeah.
You think that they're not going to do
the same one? The same one
that
thinks they're going to win the Indiana State Convention for governor?
This isn't a personal axe to grind. This is a person who has spent a lot of time and a lot of effort and a lot of passion on the Libertarian Party. Mm-hmm. And this is a person who in 2012 didn't have the organization to properly get on the ballot, then came up against the Republicans challenging his ballot signatures, got kicked off and had those signatures thrown out because he didn't hire a lawyer against the advice of myself and Rupert's campaign team and Libertarian lawyers.
His own campaign team.
Here's a candidate that I've heard through the grapevine allegedly didn't pay or had to be threatened to get money for the services rendered in his 2012 campaign. You know, I mean, that's just bad campaign management.
Yeah.
And then you look at this election cycle where January 3rd or 4th, Brett Bittner and I sit down with the guy and say, okay, because of episode 144, Karen's story, I went into that meeting with a very negative impression. I'll admit, my emotions were tied to him.
Domestic abuse has been a hot topic for you for the last 12
months. Absolutely, because of Karen's story. And I sat down with the guy and I sat across from him and I went, okay, that is not that guy. These are two separate cases. This is somebody who has his version of reality. I've talked to the ex-wife. She has her version of reality. We're not going to be able, and nor should we as a political party, be deciding what did or did not happen. All that matters is the political problem. You are a one-issue candidate. Did you or did you not beat your wife? And I'm not the one saying that. That is every person who Googles your name after the two televised debates wants to know, whoa, he seems reasonable, but there's these two articles, because you're not going to be able to reputation.com away the Daily Mail.
Or trying to scrub anything from the internet. There's been college campuses that try to spend millions of dollars trying to get stuff scrubbed from the internet.
$32,000 for California University. The you remember the famous pepper spray, and it's all back.
UC Santa Barbara.
Well, the other thing with it is, there's other ways. Like I said, they're not going to bring it up. What if John Gregg and Mike Pence both guys says like, I've got my Indiana, you know, handgun permit. Where's yours?
Yeah.
Oh, you can't get yours. Why? Oh, sorry.
So, Harry, I just look at it and I go, listen, you're too much risk.
Yeah.
You're not a good candidate in the Republican Party. You've not been able to message away your problem in this party.
You're not welcome.
You are not welcome in the party. You were an alternate.
Yeah.
You were an alternate at your own convention 3 weeks, 4 weeks ago. The delegates selected you as first alternate. You couldn't even make one of the four spots. And it's because people don't believe you, they don't find you authentic, and they're worried that you are a liability. Because the Republicans think you're a liability, and just because...
They don't think of you at all.
Right. Yeah. I'm sorry.
They're totally indifferent to you.
They're salivating, I sure hope.
But when I ask around Republican contacts that I still have, that are lobbyists in this state, it is, what are you even talking about?
Right. Just because... Yeah. So sometimes people think that the Republicans' trash is the Libertarians' treasure, and that's not the case.
Nope.
And so I look at
trash
it.
Trash is trash.
I go, well, I'm going to nominate a person who has a very bad track record as a candidate in two gubernatorial election cycles.
Mm-hmm.
Once as a Republican, and this time as a Libertarian, because you talk to county chairs, you talk to other candidates, and they're just like, no, I gave him the benefit of the doubt.
Yeah.
And then you stack that up against Rex Bell, who is the arguably one of the most successful candidates in the history of the Libertarian Party.
Yes.
And somehow he's the safe choice? He is the safe choice. He's the smart choice.
Mm-hmm.
He's the best choice. He's going to be the most successful choice.
He's the only choice. If you legitimately want to win the election, there's only one choice.
Right.
And so any delegate that's listening, I'm a delegate too. That's going to make people mad. I don't care. And so it bugs me that one, a bunch of people that have watched The West Wing probably 6-7 times think that all of a sudden at the Antelope Club that makes you amateur politico. That doesn't make you amateur politico. You don't know what you're talking about. You have no delegations. You guys get drunk and talk about things that you don't actually exist. What bugs me is that you think there is this mythical group of Republicans that doesn't exist, or the Libertarian Party would have grown tenfold over the last 10 years because social conservatism is dying. If that were the case, the Republican Party in Indiana would be down 20% and the Libertarian Party would be up about 10. There'd be 10% mm-hmm. trying to find a home.
Yeah.
Yep. So that isn't the case. It has never been the case. And the reason is because Libertarian votes come from both sides. They don't just come from one.
Yes.
They draw evenly from both sides.
Mm-hmm.
And if you want to win this election, you're going to win Democratic votes, rural Democratic votes, the kind of votes that Rex Bell has gone, spent time with, rebuilt their homes, renovated their homes, renovated their mm-hmm. bathrooms, and shook their hands in diners all throughout his district.
Yep.
Anything else you think is irrelevant. The other candidate, Jim Wallace, is actually has always been good to me.
Yeah.
I have no issue with Jim. I have an issue with his team, and I'm going to crush his team and continue to and beat him like badminton.
And let me say, truthfully, Wallace has been open to answer any of my questions. He wanted to come on and talk to us here on the show. We declined because...
I want to talk to him because I like Jim. I don't like his team.
Yeah, I declined just because I don't want to have to, spend time arguing that issue. Because I just know that he doesn't have an answer because I've heard it on other radio shows and two debates. And I just go, if you want to hear the debates, raw audio politics, you can hear his answer. And I just go, I don't want to give exposure to a candidate who's just not good for the party. You know what I mean? I just
don't care because he can't win.
Yeah.
Literally, that's it. He cannot win.
And our policy, by and large, is that the majority, we just don't have candidates on. We're a national show, and to have a local, a Republican or Democratic or Libertarian candidate on to interview them, it just doesn't do our audience any good. It takes up our valuable time. We can interview hundreds of candidates, and it just...
We're not even going to interview Gary Johnson, Austin Peterson, or John McAfee. We're going to turn it down.
If it really comes up and
if they make us have them on, we will.
But it just, it's like, I don't know.
I like those guys.
But long story short, Jim has been nice to me. Jim has been cooperative with me. We haven't exchanged words. I do think that they're, I'm trying very, very hard, despite his team, and two people specifically.
Yeah, that's true.
It's just two people.
They need to go back.
They need to go back to their own party.
I personally have found Wallace to be a decent guy, friendly guy. I think he's well-spoken, and if he didn't have the one issue, he'd be a good... He might be a good candidate.
Mm-hmm.
But...
If he... Honestly, all I care if he answered it one different way. If he owned it, it happened. I screwed up. I'm a different man than I used to be.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I'm really sorry, and I'm going to do everything I can to prove that that isn't me anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Done. I'm your biggest advocate.
Yep. Yep.
So I just
training, anger management, got all these stuff set in place. It was like, here's like yes, I've suffered. This is what I've learned.
I'm sorry. I can't buy into it. I've been a part of those campaigns where you just go, with Rupert's campaign, I stood up there and I said, this is going to change everything for us. Because I honestly, truly believed it at the time.
It did. It gave you every reason, everything they're benefiting from this cycle is because of that decision.
And
I don't care who disagrees, they're wrong. Because
I've
met a lot of the Libertarian leadership and most of them have terrible opinions.
Yeah. And so I've been part of a group of people who think that this campaign is going to change everything. We've got the candidate that has the energy, the message. He's going to raise all this money. He's going to work every county. And let me just tell you something. Libertarian Party's not there. And when you have a political party that in a state of 92 counties doesn't have a name in 50 counties to give a yard sign to, you cannot win the gubernatorial race. You cannot win that race. There is no amount of money, wishful thinking, whatever, that will win that race. It is a math problem, Harry.
Yep. Yes.
And so,
yep.
When you don't have, you can print off.
And if anyone were going to, if somehow, let's say Mike Pence got indicted and John Gregg came out as a wife beater.
Mm-hmm.
You context sometimes creates it. Only one candidate would withstand that.
And it's Rex Bell.
Yep.
And so when you don't have, it's a grassroots game. And the Libertarian Party has spent so much time for a party of tech nerds, they have no ability to manage their technology. There is no grassroots organization. There is no database. Nope. You've got to fix that. You cannot run before you can walk. Mm-hmm. And so the gubernatorial race, the U.S. Senate race, and the televised debates and the upper ballot races become marketing opportunities.
Mm-hmm. They're the only ones you get.
They're the only marketing opportunities that you get. Mm-hmm. And so most people are never going to hear the name Rex Bell or Jim Wallace, except for the televised debates, because Indiana, by law, or by agreement, is part of the debates.
Andy Horning's treatment of Richard Murdoch in the last go-round for Senate changed my parents' entire neighborhood's perception of libertarianism and created libertarian voters.
Right.
It wasn't because of his message. It was because of the class and the kindness he handled Richard Murdoch's backlash he faced, mm-hmm. which is everything. It's all about how you make people feel. What you say mm-hmm. is irrelevant. And the way Andy handled it was so classy and so kind. That's the kind of people they know they could put in office and trust. And that's the, you know, I gave a speech at the Henry County convention, and it was about the trust gap that exists and what we have to do to overcome it. And Rex fills that gap, because when he shakes your hand, you know it's true.
Mm-hmm.
When any other politician shakes your hand, you say, well, once I've won my last election, then I'll start, you know, maybe we'll do it if I have the political capital.
Yeah.
That's the entire difference in reason there's a true chance of growth with Rex, and no upside and only downside with the other candidate.
And so what we have done here with libertarians is you've got to think differently. You've got to act differently. You've got to be different. And I'm not saying wear the Hawaiian shirt in the televised debate to be different. I'm saying you've got to offer something people special, so they mm-hmm. feel that they can actually connect to a political philosophy and a political party again.
Yep.
And by hoping, wishing, dreaming for a politician to save our party, it's wrongheaded. Because a politician can't save us. The candidate who is the most successful candidate in the Indiana Libertarian history is going to do far better based on past results than a person who has not proven themselves in character or as a candidate. I'm sorry. And it doesn't mean that this is a personal thing, because
honestly, it isn't personal. It's about winning.
It is about winning, and it is about winning elections. And we are a political party, and that's what we do. I want to ask Harry, because we've got an official tech geek here. Reputation.com or whatever. Like, I honestly don't know the answer to this, so it's not necessarily a leading question. I mean, I have like theories, but. Is there a way to scrub that, or, you know, because, listen, I say, listen, here's the, you got a Google problem. That's like your number one problem. That's the thing you got to solve.
Mm-hmm.
Is that solvable? I mean, is that a fair thing for me to, like, say to that campaign, like, you got to fix this thing, and then maybe we'll talk?
Once Google technically has got its teeth in it, it's got it. You can try to bury it underneath pages, like adding different small content.
And but for Google's weeks, algorithm, like little weak periods at a time, you can.
Yeah.
With mm-hmm. negative SEO by linking it to spam farms.
Yeah.
But other than that, they're going to change the algorithm and catch it.
It's going to come back. Yeah, it's going to catch it and come back. And nothing truly leaves the internet. And once anybody starts doing any digging whatsoever, they're going to find it.
Then you're blacklisted.
Yeah, I do small digging on my Nexus 7 every time a job candidate comes in. When I'm interviewing somebody, I just start digging on them and who they are. You know, just a quick Google search and get it on, and, you know, find out who they are.
Well, I do that, and then I do their email address, because mm-hmm. then I know if they're like into some weird things or have done weird things, or sure. then I'll Google search any like user profile that, or like username that's attached to that email address.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because you can go down the rabbit hole pretty quick by just doing those things, but it gives you a good idea of everything. And it's different. Like, it's different if it's the Indy Star that wrote an article.
Yeah.
Or the Evansville Courier Press, or yeah. yada yada yada. The UK Daily Mail is so universal mm-hmm. and so large that you can you know, negative SEO that to death and link it to spam farms and try to hope that that kicks it to page 3. But in time, they're going to update the algorithm, because
yeah.
their Google's entire business model is based off of PageRank, which mm-hmm. is how you. It's just the same as academic citing.
And they're going to find it, and they're going to just go like push it back. They're going to push it back and ignore you.
And like, yeah, they'll block any AdWords.
Boom.
They'll block the Libertarian Party of Indiana's AdWords account if uh-huh. they're, you know, if they think that's what's going on.
Yeah.
Not that they would spend the money on that, but
or hit the word libertarian as a spam word.
Mm-hmm.
Look at that spam word there. But once something's on the net, it's there.
It's always there.
It's there. It's never going away. The Wayback Machine holds everything.
Oh, people can, that's where the deleted stuff is.
Yeah. People like to go over and use archive.is to take live snapshots of people's comments and stuff like that. It happened a huge big during Gamergate when all these SJWs were saying these horrendous things on Twitter. And people were just like, okay, I'm going to archive IS this thing. This thing's now a live document of everything you just said. And was just using that to bring down a lot of different people who were trying to get rid of stuff.
That's what they do. That's what this is ultimately about, is that it should be an immediate disqualifier if you have to hire a company in order to hide your past in order to be viable.
To someone like me, it's hard for me to accept anyone who won't if he would go out and admit that he did wrong, it's something I could probably listen to it. It's the same reason why I really haven't really talked to my father. He refuses to, honestly, to this day, to admit that he did domestic violence to my mother. It's hard. It's always a non-starter with my father. I don't like talking to him because he won't admit that he did harm back then. So it's kind of like, I won't even talk to my own father because of this. So what do you think a candidate, right, who's talked about hitting their mother is going to do to me, someone like me? And I'm not alone here in Indiana.
No, domestic violence is incredibly prevalent. And that's the challenge for Wallace, is that you're not fighting, let's say you're 100% innocent, mm-hmm. okay? Despite the diversion, you're just innocent, okay? And it's totally a he said, she said. The charges in the public record mean you are now fighting the imagination of every voter that comes across this information. And you can't hide it, like we just talked about. You got to deal with it. And so when you say to me, well, I wish I could give you the whole truth, but there's a non-disclosure agreement and we can't tell you the whole truth, but you got to just trust me, it's not as bad as it sounds. Okay, well,
now how do I go defend you?
How do I go defend you? I can't go to someone like my sister or my family.
Or Abdul or Howie or anyone influential that can actually affect votes.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The proposition is, can you prepare down ballot candidates and supporters and Libertarian Party members to defend your record?
Right.
Not your policy positions.
Mm-hmm. So even if you get past his record, stuff like that, right? And then you try to go policy positions. So he's already down. You're already down, people's perception. And then now you're going to try to go against someone who's got great name recognition, who's the incumbent, who probably is going to win.
Who has unlimited financial backing from the Republican National Committee because he's one of their stable... He's been a horse in the stable for years, and his presidential aspirations aren't quite over yet.
No. He's going to run, or he's going to be someone's big VP.
Yeah, I mean, even he'd be good at a lot of things. Mike Pence, shockingly, is probably at his worst in politics, to tell you the truth, because he's not suited to being an executive because he's a messenger.
Yeah.
And he's not a good guy to lead the charge, but he's a very good counterpuncher. Because he's strong, he's authoritative, he looks the part, mm-hmm. and he's quick-witted when he's not arguing from a position of being behind.
Right.
Yeah. John Gregg, to me, I don't know. John Gregg is...
He's the same.
I mean, John Gregg, though, is he's like a worse version. He will never get higher than local politics. Mike Pence has already been on the third highest ranking Republican, and on the Sunday shows and a staple. John Gregg would get crushed. On any of those shows.
John Gregg's that caramel Democrat who's like, yeah, I know black people. I go and help them down there downtown. It's like, no. He's that kind of people that sit there and just try to do their best. Like, oh, you're one of the downtown. I'm trying to help. It's like, I don't need your help. Just get out of my damn way.
And that's the ugly truth of the setup of the Indiana electorate. There are two LGBT communities in the entire state. One's Marion County, where it's just big enough to have a slight electoral effect on an outcome in an election. In Bloomington, where it's negligible.
Yeah.
Those are the only two.
Yeah.
Everything else is Donut County Republicans who are, you know, they're Mitch Obama voters in 08. Mm-hmm. And then, but usually they're going to side just to be a Mitch Daniels Republican because they don't love social conservatism. But given low taxes and not letting gays marry, they're going to vote for low taxes. And then there's the rural FDR Democrats. There's the farmers who, they made it through tough times because of price floors from FDR. Their parents, their, mm-hmm. their grandparents grew up idolizing a man that got people through the Depression and World War II and was an icon and created a lasting coalition. Mm-hmm. That means that you either have to win enough Republicans, which libertarians have constantly tried and never works, or you go after people who are going to have to say, wow, John Gregg, the guy I know and trusted and has come and shook my hand, is now saying he's going to marry gay people, and they're saying mm-hmm. it in their, you know, their VFW hat, and they're sitting mm-hmm. in the Legion having a beer. That is the way, and Mike Pence has no other option. If Mike Pence runs a regular election saying that he's done well on the economy, John Gregg will hammer him on RFRA, he will hammer him on Carrier, mm-hmm. and he will hammer him on making the state look bad and position himself as the candidate you'll never have to apologize for voting for.
Right.
Yep.
It's that simple, and to think anything else means you don't know what you're talking about.
I've studied politics since I was 12 years old. I mean, I've worked in politics in some capacity as both a reporter, as a, you know, doing this, a member of the media, working as a state party executive, training hundreds of candidates. I've seen pretty much everything. I know what I'm talking about. My gut is not wrong here. There is something missing from one candidate, and everything we need is in the other. The choice is clear to me, plain and simple.
If you're a delegate listening, or you are going to talk to people who are on the fence, or talk to people who are find me toxic and, you know, terrible, have them listen to this.
Yeah.
And if they can find any fault in any of my reasoning whatsoever, I swear to you, I will sit down and tell them, you know what, you're actually right, and I'll amend my position. But from my read on it, and from what Harry's looked at the same voter information I have, there is no other option for actually winning than picking off disillusioned Democrats because mm-hmm. the guy that they used to trust all of a sudden is walking in the pride parade.
Yeah, there's no other way to do it.
Mm-hmm. And that's if you can
look,
do that.
Yeah, if you look at the numbers, it's like, these mountains are too big.
Mm-hmm.
Even in some counties, Rupert got more votes than Gary Johnson.
Mm-hmm. That's because he's a crossover candidate.
Yeah.
So that's it.
That's
I think it's interesting in some respects. I'm sorry if it didn't apply, but I do think, you know, part of what we've tried to do is document our excursion through this process to give you an idea of what it's like in the Libertarian Party. And listen, it's not much different than it is in other parties. And we've talked about it. If you think the Libertarian Party is going to be the perfect party and the solution for all your problems, you're setting yourself up for disappointment because it's a political party. And it's just any group of humans, there's going to be things, you know, I don't know. So I just want to say, like, if you think I'm toxic, if you think Greg is toxic, if you think this podcast is toxic, I'm sorry. Unsubscribe. Don't follow me on Facebook. Block our page. Don't talk to us anymore. That's what it takes.
It doesn't mean we're not going to talk to you. We'll talk to you. Right. We have Chris is an experienced politico. Same here. I don't take this personally. This isn't get personal to me.
It's become personal for me. But also because
you know it did have, you know, this is all new to me. Yeah. I don't have anything invested. I just see this. This is my read on the situation. I'm someone that's followed politics pretty closely. I actually, you know, read polls,
right.
And you know don't. Mm-hmm. Well, I won't say that, but. You know, I actually do know what I'm talking about in this area, and there is no path to victory with the alternative.
Yep.
As a delegate, there is no money.
Mm-hmm.
That promise of money isn't real.
Yep.
So don't let that affect you. I mean, you can want it to be if you think it is, but it won't be.
Yeah.
And at the end of the day, it comes down to when you shake Rex Bell's hand, you never have to pull up your computer.
Mm-hmm.
And it's as simple as that.
So we went to a Trump rally yesterday.
We did.
Speaking of candidates you don't trust and inauthentic people.
He's authentically Donald Trump.
Yes, very much so.
I mean, if that makes any sense at all.
We had different reads on this. I think going into it, let's talk about what our expectations were. What were your expectations of what we would find at a Donald Trump rally?
I thought it would be more angry.
Yeah.
It was surprisingly subdued, especially before he took the stage. It was like you and I both talked. I could not get over the not the lower socioeconomic status makeup. It was very... I tell you what, it was a lot of polos and khakis.
It was 60% blue or white collar.
It was. It wasn't the blue collar male. Now, there were a lot of the blue collar males there, and they, you know, they were the ones that gave it the energy. But it was, I mean, it was every bit. I mean, I don't know if it was 75-25. I mean, it was 75-25 male to female, maybe 70-30. But the women were high class. Like, or like, you know, they were like caramel yoga mops. Yeah.
No, not caramel. It was a Noblesville crowd.
Yeah.
It was okay, so going to Noblesville.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. That's better. Yeah. You know. But
white trash with money.
Hmm. Right. But now there were the crazies, and then one, I was so embarrassed at the protesters. Talk about the like millennials have ruined protesting. They're like, like they're the biggest like quiet whiners I've ever seen.
Yeah,
and it was incredible. They were treated extremely well, and that was something I wasn't expecting. I thought an angry mob was going to start yelling at him for taking down the God Emperor, and they actually made an announcement before. It was like incredibly easy to get into and out of.
It really was.
It was a well run event.
I thought that it was going to be much more. I thought it was going to be bigger, and I thought it was going to be disorganized. It was probably what would you say 4 or 5,000 people.
He was going to run an event. He knows how to.
He actually, or his people do. Like, no, I don't think he's in it, but like,
so
I was shocked.
He knows how to run an event. He knows how to hire the right people.
Getting in, like, because I actually was led to the wrong place, so I went in with the general public, and Chris got to go in with the media, and so it was better than any TSA I've ever been through.
Yeah,
I mean, it was incredible. I got through. They took it. They looked at my stuff. They put it down. They walked me through. They wanted me down, and I was out. And then they like, you know, when I needed to go get my press pass, they were like, "Oh yeah, right over here." Like, led me over there.
Well, you can tell.
I was just treated well, and I've never been treated, like, decent at a political event.
You can see our insights at WeAreLibertarians.com. Greg and I both wrote an article, and there's a lot of video on my post called A Different Libertarian Experience at the Trump Rally. I talk about the crowd. I talk about the reporters. I grab some of the protester stuff. It was 30% female, which surprised me, and the crowd was largely millennial and Gen X.
Mm-hmm.
It was not low class, blue collar.
It wasn't
baby boomers.
Yeah, it was not at all industrial blue collar like I really would have thought.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I found it to be boring. Like, honestly, the crowd was not angry. The crowd was very calm and peaceful and polite. Which, it's Indiana, man. Hoosiers are the best, and they're not going to be contentious. And Donald Trump, even at one point in the ceremony, pageantry, whatever you call it.
The tent revival.
Get him out of here!
Yeah.
And then he goes, listen, Indiana's very different. You say get out of here, and they get out of here.
Yeah. Yeah.
So... Yeah. That was funny.
I was shocked because I've heard so many politicians come in and do the thing where they try to be relatable.
Yeah.
And he actually, like, I actually buy him when he talks about, for some reason, like, the Colts. Like, I think he's probably an NFL fan, like, not a fake NFL fan.
I think he is, but
he likes football.
Definitely panders to the crowd.
Oh, yeah, but I mean, every politician's going to, but, like, you know, it's one of those things where if John Kasich were to talk about the Colts, I'd be like, get out.
Yeah.
But Donald Trump does it, and I'm like, you know what? He knows Tom Brady. Like, he probably did watch most of the Colts game, or, you know, a few Monday night games this year, and has talked to Andrew Luck.
So Trump didn't go out there with, like, you know, with some milk and a tender giant tenderloin. Woo, love being
right.
In Indiana.
Yeah, mostly. He did Trump, but kind. Yeah, that's what it is.
He was like, Hoosiers are the toughest people I know.
Yeah, but I mean, he did it, like, instead of eating a tenderloin and talking about, like, Cracker Barrel.
Yeah.
Instead, it was like Donald Trump doing Indiana. Hmm. Which was nice to see. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't Mitt Romney eating corn on the cob at the state fair.
Sorry.
So Hillary's going to be eating the giant tenderloin when she comes.
Right, because she's like the most inauthentic candidate ever.
Oh, yeah. Harry, I think you'll be surprised to know that the crowd is 98% white.
I figured that when you said khakis and polo. Yeah. And Fisher's and Noblesville crowd.
What are you saying? Kanye West doesn't wear khakis and polo?
I will say that the Black Lives Matter folks were there, and we're protesters.
That was the only protesters I saw.
Yeah, and I got a video of this, and I got picked up by a newswire, actually. I saw two girls, I'd say they were black, but I think they were probably of mixed race. They were younger, probably high school students. Mm-hmm. Very sweet looking, very, you know, they were there, they looked like scared kids, because they, you know, and they caught my eye, because they were wearing shirts that were homemade with markers that said, "Wake up America," and America had 3 K's, and then at the bottom, "Feel the burn." Not crazy that, you know, teenagers would like Bernie Sanders. And I just looked at that and I go, you know what, I wouldn't have had the guts to do that when I was in high school. And I, like, found myself admiring them, because they weren't clear. They were clearly not, like, the professional protester. Mm-hmm. They were just, they have convictions.
They might have passed out yard signs, but they weren't a paid staffer or AstroTurf.
Absolutely not. And so they just wanted to make a statement, and they're young and getting involved in the political process. And I thought, you know what, that's awesome. And so I just wanted to kind of keep an eye on them. Because, A, I felt like a little paternalistic. I was like, you know what, this crowd, you never know what Trump people are like. I'm going to keep an eye on them and make sure, like, if anything happens, like, I can at least, you know, speak on their behalf or whatever.
Well, those two, though, like, they were in the back left, right?
Yeah.
Like, they like, couldn't protest because it never got rabid enough.
Yeah.
Like, they just had to stand there till, like, nearly the whole thing was over.
They were
it was weird.
I don't even know if that was their intention. Because they
but, like, some of the protesters, like, never protested because it never got angry enough.
Right. And so they were right behind this kid who had a Trump loves Tom Brady sign. And they were way more obnoxious than these girls. But a Trump security guard saw their shirt. And so I had been kind of keeping an eye on them for like 10 minutes just to see, like, all right, I see protesters. I want to see what they do. I want to see how the crowd reacts. I want to see what happens to them. And the Trump guy saw their shirt and was ready to remove them. The people around these girls started protesting their removal.
Yeah.
I know. And I don't know if they were friends of theirs. One of them, you know, they didn't seem like it. One girl who was, like, loudly in the video that I got protesting their removal was wearing an American flag and Constitution t-shirt, you know, and seemed like a Tea Partier. And so what ended up happening is the girls got thrown out, and the people that stood up for the girls and said, they're not doing anything, they seem really nice, leave them. They got thrown out too. And they took the kid with the Tom Brady sign.
That, he needed to be.
It's Tom Brady.
So I posted it. I immediately was like, yes, viral content. And put it up, and it got a bunch of views on her Facebook page. So it's really interesting to see how that happened.
Watermarked the video, right?
No. It belongs to the internet now, Harry. I know YouTube won't be able to hear this, but I want to play this Trump supporter yelling at a CNN reporter. The national anthem played, and the CNN reporter, listen, when you're a reporter and you're traveling with a campaign, and you're with, like, you're with Reuters or Bloomberg or CNN, and you're a photographer, like, I picked up a bunch of tidbits from the reporters. I was sitting next to a Reuters photographer. He said Reuters spent $40,000 in hotels on the Iowa caucuses, which is, like, crazy to me. So it was interesting to, like, hear the other reporters' stories about everything. But you just get so burnt out on it, and you're, like, you're just at a point where you go, listen, how many times do I gotta sing the national anthem? And, like, personally, I didn't, you know, I don't care about the national anthem, and it's named after me. I mean, and I'll explain that some other time, but, like, to me, the pledge and the national anthem and all that stuff is, like, pledging allegiance to a nationalistic border that I don't really believe in. So this is one guy yelling at the CNN reporter for not standing up on the pledge. All right, so that was kind of funny. This was beforehand, and I thought this was really interesting to hear what they announce.
Safe space.
So yeah, that was the message. Then there was also the portion, you know, this is all very rote. He comes out, he starts out, and he talks, he does this in every rally if you watch it. Comes out and he starts talking about the polls. He had won the night before in New York, a pretty big victory. Yeah.
Huge. 85 of 95 delegates.
You know.
That's huge.
Yeah. I think mathematically eliminating
Cruz and
Ted
Kasich.
Cruz from the winning the primaries outright, they'd have to win it.
No one else has a shot now.
Yeah.
And one of my favorite portions is always when he blames the media. When he comes after the media and he does the following. He said that because we are literally sitting, like, everybody
front
in the
row.
Crowd. You got to see the video. It's on WeAreLibertarians.com. Look for my post on it. We're front row, and, like, he is pointing directly at Greg, Rob Kendall, and myself. And Rob Kendall, I've never seen a media member in my life in the media pen wearing campaign gear. He showed up in a Marlon Stutzman for U.S. Senate t-shirt and a Donald Trump Make America Great Again hat, which is not done. You don't do that. Like,
oh, no,
you violated
that's
so much
what's
code.
So funny is he's pointing back there, and there's Rob in the middle of this sea of reporters with a red Make America Great Again hat, smiling and going like this.
Yeah, all the photos, like, and so, like, he's like, oh, you know, like 75% of them are awful and dishonest. Thank you. And so at the end of that video, I have I scanned over to Rob and got him in his hat. But it's just so funny. And, like, he clearly doesn't hate the media because We Are Libertarians got two press passes.
Oh, yeah. We wouldn't have gotten him to Cruz. We wouldn't have gotten to Hillary, Bernie maybe. But We wouldn't have gotten them to anybody else.
I'm going to try and get... but if not, then we're going to use our super secret backdoor way to get into some of these. Because we want to experience this stuff. Like, I don't like Donald Trump. I didn't find him... nothing about him changed my mind. My perception of the crowd was changed. But it's you get a different perspective when you show up to events and you are part of the media pit and you see the rally for yourself. But we were surrounded by college newspapers.
I was amazed. The guy that sat next to you, the photographer, I won't say his name, he went from, I think, completely skeptical. Like, not, like you know, he you know wasn't excited. He's there, yada, yada, too. After we kind of talked, it kind of like, it kind of struck a chord. And I thought, that's pretty shocking to me. You know, because that isn't the experience you have. There just aren't many Trump voters. There aren't people out there that hear Donald Trump and say, okay. You know, that say, you know, that's not so bad. You know, it's he's, you know, Hitler, or he's going to make, you know, he's the God Emperor that's here to save us all.
Yeah, I don't know that his mind was... I mean, my mind, certainly. He's talked for 55 minutes, and he was just very long-winded, and I was so bored.
Yeah, I mean, if you go over here, policy... You know, it's a tent revival. He's a Baptist, you know.
It was pageantry. It was not a Nazi rally. It was pageantry.
To me, it feels like church.
Because when you watch that video of the media, you can find it on our YouTube channel, too. When you watch that video where they're booing the media, look at the smile on everybody's face.
They're smiling because we're howling. I was howling, thinking it was so funny. I'm like, oh, damn it.
I was waving. I was loving the attention.
And the people are crying, laughing at it.
Because, like...
Because they know we're not bad.
Yeah, I mean, look at us. We're nice. We're nice American boys. I don't know what that means, but
if they'd only known we were libertarians, they might have had different
opinions. Get them out of here. Yeah. Back door, please.
Like, listen to this. I mean, he's when Donald Trump says this about you, then what can you do? Those people, Harry.
Yeah.
Greg's dishonest. I've heard that on a while.
He's a libertarian.
We're the worst.
Bad libertarians.
Harry, you're very dishonest. Greg, you're terrible.
Yeah.
Chris Spangle is part of that 75%. I do know it. Oh, I'm definitely not stupid. So yeah, it's just funny. It's like, you're just sitting there, so surreal. I'm like, everybody's just having the... It was really like a comedy show crowd. It wasn't a Nazi crowd.
It is, though. I think it's pretty impressive, because he talked for a long time. Like, just flat out. Talked for a long time, and he doesn't say... Like, it's not like he goes into a deep policy discussion, debating the finer points or anything like that. He does it he has the most peculiar speech pattern I've ever heard. I've never heard anyone else be able to speak how he does and not just come across as like Tourette's or like multiple personalities or
better than the current president. You know, we're going to do things, you know, and make it great again, okay? So that's what we're going to do.
Let me be clear.
Yeah. I just need you to get on my side here.
Yeah, and like, you know, not everybody's a good extemporaneous speaker, and I think that's what I'm always most impressed by, because I think he walks out there with maybe an outline.
Yeah.
And then he just goes.
Yeah.
I mean, 55 minutes
of rambling. Of stream of consciousness rambling.
But he does usually stay, like, he hits his main points, and he does mid, it's constant, like, he has a thought, and a new one pops in his head, and he goes on that tangent, and then, but then he wraps it back, and I'm like, man, I'd forget about my tangents, but he comes back. It's like he's got like ADD and all these ideas pop in his head mid-sentence.
Well, do you listen to this show? That's all we do.
Yeah. I guess.
That's Emily. We hadn't even planned.
Thinks about lots of different things. So.
Yeah, we hadn't even planned to talk about the first hour of this show. We were like, oh, let's not talk about it. We'll talk about the Trump rally.
Yeah. I mean, the Trump rally was...
Hi, honey.
Who is this?
Love you.
Love you, too.
You're so cute.
You too about that.
That's my girlfriend, Emily.
Oh.
Have I told you guys about her?
I haven't heard about her.
No. So, you want to come on the show?
I'm a very busy man.
She's a very important businessman. She
I
can't
am.
Yeah, come on over.
Come on, sit in.
So
we're getting ready to talk about Saudi Arabia.
Give her a microphone. Give her the yellow one, please. So don't. Well,
that's sorry.
Fine. You're fine. In the video.
No, I just had to scoot the chair.
So Emily's. We're going to do this, but to sum up the Trump rally before we talk to Emily. To sum up the Trump rally, what are your kind of final thoughts on it?
I mean, it is what it is. It's a Southern Baptist tent revival thing. It gets people fired up who feel like they haven't been listened to for a very long time, riled up. He shockingly unites a crowd I wouldn't think would hang out,
mm-hmm.
and does it well. And to be honest, he's a better speaker than Ted Cruz and John Kasich.
You think?
To me, he is, because he actually... John Kasich just comes off as like Mr. Rogers.
Your annoying uncle.
Yeah, and Ted Cruz, I think, I don't know, I've never been more, like, detested by someone's mannerisms and, like, just general look. And I don't trust him at all. But yeah. Donald Trump, his rawness and the unfinished product, for some reason, feels a little bit more real to me. And it's more appealing than someone that's so polished.
Yeah. Breaking news from Infowars.com. They ask the tough questions at AlexJones.com. Did the chemtrail flu kill Prince and Merle Haggard? Was Prince killed by the chemtrails he and Haggard spoke out against? So make sure you check up at Infowars.com.
I can't believe you follow them.
Aaron just put it in a chat.
Oh, so I know he follows them.
You can't be seen on the camera.
What do you mean?
I can put you on the camera if you
want. Oh, no.
Okay.
Just in case.
She was making faces at the camera, but she didn't realize he can't see her.
It's better to look ugly on purpose than on accident.
All right, ready? Do it.
Emily, have you formally met Harry Price?
Hi.
Emily, I'm Harry.
This is
nice
Harry Price.
You?
This is.
Are we friends on Facebook?
No.
Probably.
You should be.
No.
Friends of the world on Facebook.
So Emily.
We can be.
Oh, and last thought on the Trump rally. They were introducing all of his campaign team. He's going to get slaughtered in Indiana.
Oh, my God.
His 7th district person is a guy named Bob Crotty that lost the primary to Andy Horning, who up to that point had only run as a Libertarian and then ran as a Republican one cycle in 2004. Bob Crotty is the biggest nut. Like, he is such a nice guy. But he couldn't organize a birthday party. Yeah. So when he's your 7th district organizer, that's a problem.
That's 7th district.
Do you have anything to add on Trump?
It's 7th district. When I do listen to Trump's rally speeches, I like, the energy is kind of like addictive. You have to like sit there, like snap yourself back into reality and go like, wait a minute, this is that St. Christopher's speech, this is one trying to get me right up to go into battle, wait a minute, what am I really listening to here? It's that, you know, to me, I watch a lot of Gundam anime, and it always feels like that speech right before they go to battle or try to get everyone on their side.
You know, he does, like, people are desperate to be led, though. Like, leadership, people, like, just are so thirsty for it. Like, if they see a mirage, they'll go up and drink the sand.
Yeah, but I'm an ENTJ, I don't mind it, but, you know, I can do myself.
Harry Price, the only ENTJ I've ever liked.
ENTJ.
Oh, okay.
I'm an ENTJ. All right,
well,
Brett
never
Bender.
Mind, I've never liked
like Brett Bender.
Little Brett Bender?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. He's more extroverted than I am, he scored more higher on the extroverted side, but...
Emily is an INFJ. And I'm an ENFJ.
I thought I was something else.
No, you're an INFJ. Trust me, you're a rare
HIV breed. Plus?
Yeah.
Sorry, that's not a Myers-Briggs.
Honey, you have the AIDS?
Yes.
No.
Everyone
not full
has
scale.
AIDS.
All of them.
Good thing we've never had sex.
It's pre-op.
That's true.
So what are you up to?
Oh, I got here to... practice my comedy in a dark room before doing it tonight.
What do you have any new jokes that you're gonna tell?
I'm gonna talk about being really fat in middle school.
I can relate. Greg, you?
What would be a good nah? I wore sweater vests, which was really weird.
About the same as now.
Yeah, that is true. But now they're Colombian and they're not wool.
No, it's on purpose.
And much less Republican.
Emily, what did you just pick up on the table that you thought was adorable?
Oh, these Libertarian bumper stickers. That's just cute.
How did Chris do talking to your family, who are more Republican than Chris is? How did he stand up?
He got real fired up. It was great. He's very passionate.
Yes, yes I am.
My whole family, except me, loves to argue, so they all loved it. And I just kind of sat there and...
Wishing she were dead.
Yeah.
Right. Not just.
Oh, you don't enjoy it?
He handled it well. He knows what he knows and why he knows it. So...
What do you think of a boyfriend who likes politics?
It's precious.
Is it?
Yeah.
See, that's why I love
it. It's just your fun little thing that you do, and it's cute.
See, that's why it's my dream girl. That's
he's just libertying.
I just don't care about
it. You go. You save the world.
Much.
Yeah.
Take her to one pork fest. She'll be fun.
Oh, boy. Oh, my.
I really wanted to take her to the Trump rally.
Oh, you'd have loved it.
Probably.
You really would. And, well, you know what? There wasn't as much good material there to make fun of as you'd have thought.
Mm-mm.
Like,
yeah.
Unless you like to make fun of, like, you know, I don't know, people that drive Ford Explorers and wear polos and tuck in.
That's exclusively her material.
Yeah.
That's true.
Those are just nervous dads. I love making fun of nervous dads.
Emily's a big fan of dads, aren't you?
Yeah, dad culture.
What is dad culture?
That's exactly what it sounds like.
Cargo shorts and black t-shirts.
The study of dads and the different breeds.
But I don't think our audience is familiar with the study of dads. So explain to Harry what dad culture is.
I don't know if I can. This is the first time ever trying to put it into words. Basically, there are a few types. The happy-go-lucky who's your dad. He's the kind who can't say anything. He'll just keep talking, but never say anything.
Like Phil Dunphy in Modern Family?
I don't know that show. I don't have cable
but
TV.
Yes.
But
like
yes.
That. Like
then,
Coolio. Like
like they can't, they have to fill the awkward silence.
Right.
Nervous business dad.
What's their dress like?
Fidgety.
Very, very nice. A very clean shirt all the time. Just
sort of.
Very clean, very ironed.
Like this?
No, he's more
horny.
Unkempt political dad.
This is a picture of Brett Bittner.
Anyway,
unkempt political
nervous,
dad.
Nervous business dads are just always nervous.
Yeah.
Unkempt.
So what's the other type of dad?
Oh, backyard barbecue dad, but he kind of is the same thing as happy-go-lucky who's your dad.
It's like a square is a rectangle, but not all rectangles are squares.
Right.
All they've got in life is their barbecue pit and their barbecuing skills.
And they use phrases like man cave, and they love to fish.
Fish is
just taking my boys to soccer.
Fish fear me.
Taking the boys camping this weekend.
Yeah.
What other kind of dads are there?
So many.
Don't be
so
afraid to
many.
Get racist.
Harry, talk about Harry's dad.
Triggered.
Huh?
Is Harry dad?
Does Harry have a dad vibe?
No.
He has a Terry Labonte hat on.
No, he definitely does have an anime vibe. I picked up on it immediately.
Whoa,
because
that is dead on.
Come as a shock to me when he said that. I was like, okay.
He loves anime.
Now, Harry is a LARPer. Do you
yeah.
know what a LARPer is?
Yes, I know what a LARPer is. That's great.
And he's like, not pro yet, but, you know, he's on the way.
Live action role play.
Yeah, I do that, yeah.
Harry is always trying to get me to play Dungeons & Dragons.
Yeah, which do tabletop RPG game that's pen and paper.
That
anyway, it just sort of like made something in my brain click. Like, oh, okay, now I'm comfortable with this. When he said anime, I was like, oh, that clears it up. Just like when people learn that I used to be really fat, they're like, oh, stand-up comedy. Okay, now that makes sense.
What would it, does Greg have a dad vibe?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
What's my dad vibe?
I don't know, but it's there.
Former,
there's a little glimmer of dad in your eye.
Former frat bro dad.
Frat bro dad.
Yeah.
Yeah, ready to relive the... Can't wait for his son to go to college.
You're
so,
the most dad of all.
Am I?
Yeah.
What am I?
Dad as hell.
That's right.
Dad as hell.
What?
Aggressively hydrated and dad as hell.
Aggressively hydrated and very sensible.
Honey, I forgot my water bottles at work today. This is the first 32 ounce I've had today.
Is this a prompt?
No, it's not a prompt. I'm, like, legitimately unhydrated. I'm
oh,
not
no.
well. I'm not well.
By the way, I loved your advice today when he was telling you the story of how, you know, possible lawsuit, and you said you should just be...
Hold on. So this is... Let's recreate this. This is exactly...
I don't know if I can.
Yeah, you can. You know what you said. And I go,
what you've done.
Honey, this is the first threatened lawsuit I've ever had. I don't know what I'm going to do. What should I do in the face of my first lawsuit?
Turn into an emoji. Because you can't sue a person if they're not a person. They're an emoji instead. So just be an emoji and tell them, you can't sue me, I'm an emoticon.
And I go, well, that was very helpful, thank you.
That was one of those sentences where I wasn't at all thinking about what we were talking about, and I had no idea how to help, so it just kind of fell out. And I'm sorry about it.
I'm like, I'm really nervous and stressed out about this. And you're like, I wasn't thinking about it.
Be an emoji.
It's very zen.
Thanks, Emily.
So what makes me dad as hell?
The radio laugh you just did was very dad as hell.
I don't have a radio laugh.
You do the thing that you did.
No, I don't know what you're talking about.
The glasses, the shorts.
It's everything. Like, what's not dad? About
car,
you.
Definitely the car.
The nasal spray?
Yeah. He's nailing the nasal spray.
Is it my hair? What? Emily is a very much a free spirit. Emily is, I wouldn't say sensible. She's...
I am Lizzie McGuire.
Nobody listening knows what that means.
They might.
No, they don't. Is that like Ally McBeal for your generation?
It's, yeah.
When we get together.
Yeah, Emily, it would be Ally McBeal for that young generation, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you know what Ally McBeal is?
Should I? No.
No, you shouldn't.
Yeah. No.
Yeah. It's really not a good show.
Yeah. But that's the...
Except they had that dancing baby in the unisex bathroom. That was kind of funny.
Yeah. Pretty relevant, too. Unisex bathroom.
Mm-hmm. Dancing baby.
My ears perked up at dancing baby.
Your mom is hell.
I don't know about that.
No. You're like... gonna get a drifter in the woods as hell.
Thank you so much.
So beach grove.
Did you just call her a wood nymph?
No, it's funny. If you follow Emily on Facebook, and you're allowed to add her.
I don't know.
No, she loves it. She loves the attention.
Oh, yeah. Add me on Facebook. I'm the worst there.
Emily Bewley. Emily Bewley.
Spewley.
Yeah. Emily is a local club owner of Morty's, where we will be on the 25th. Chris Bowers said, I love Emily. Emily has a totally different point of view. You never know what Emily's going to say. Like, she could be out in the woods being dressed by birds, or she could be gutting a drifter. I don't know. She could...
That's pretty accurate.
Nothing would surprise me. She could have a...
Birds are better than people.
She could have a bag full of adorable baby dolls or a bag full of heads.
What about baby doll heads?
Definitely. I know you have at least three of those in your back.
I do.
In your trunk. So.
That is so creepy.
She is. She's creepy.
I am very creepy, yes.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Yeah. So. Well, thank you for joining us.
You're welcome.
You are delightful.
Am I dismissed? You're delightful, too.
Well, you don't have to leave.
You don't have to leave, but we're going to talk about nerd stuff.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You might find comedy.
I'm going to, go to that dark room now and talk to myself.
We're walking into the library the other day. And you're going to loudly exclaim, just as you did that night, which was so hurtful to me.
Wait.
We were walking into the library on Friday night to go to an art exhibit to get some culture.
At the wonderful Plainfield Public Library.
Yeah, and I said, listen, I used to go there all the time. I used to ride my bike over here, fill my backpack with books. I know the whole Dewey Decimal System by heart.
And I said, wow, what a fucking nerd.
Yeah.
But I was in a very bad mood and I was joking.
You know, what you said was, you fucking dork.
Oh, yeah. Nerd. He rounds up.
Yeah.
Were you one of those library kids?
Oh, God, yeah. I know. I like to read the 150s, the 151s, the 152s for psychology.
Did you sit at those square tables and, like, work on your chemistry homework together with other people, or were you, like, on the film, or, like, where you could go look at the archives?
Oh, yeah, I was definitely, like, the film. I wasn't, like, the whole game was changed in Nosferatu. I wasn't, like, that nerdy, but, like, I was definitely, I started the AV Club.
You were AV Metro.
Yeah. You remember the announcements when we started the video announcements?
Those were actually awesome.
That was my idea. So in 10th grade, I said, we just didn't put TVs in all the classrooms. So I took it to the library, and I wrote out like this 2-page plan, and I said, here's what we need to do to build like a video studio, do announcements, blah, blah, blah. And the librarian took it to the board, and she like got a promotion and a raise on my idea.
Mm-hmm.
Never talked to me again. Aww. So we started a class,
Crusty
and then
broad
me and my friends started the like the first AV class, and we did all the videos. And, like, there was the one of Brady, the little guy shooting the basketball. Like, that was...
I didn't realize you guys did. I mean, I do remember, like, all of a sudden just audiovisual equipment being dumped on our high school, like, out of nowhere. Meanwhile, they made the mentally handicapped kids clean the cafeteria tables for a quarter apiece.
They did that in our school, too.
Isn't that slave labor?
They didn't pay them, though.
They paid them a quarter a table.
They got paid. These silver quarters?
Yeah, then for gym, they just locked the doors and Dana Green would throw basketballs into the middle of the floor. It was bedlam.
Hey, glad I went to IP.
It's actually kind of like a lot of things that you like on YouTube, Emily. So judge not.
What was that video?
Uh-huh.
I'm not judging. I'm fascinated.
Uh-huh.
What's the name of that video?
Special Poetry Slam.
What was the other one? The Krabby Patties.
Oh man. I can't disclose that. I'm not a bad person.
Do you know Eric? Krabby Patties?
No, I don't know.
It's Krabby basically Pat. Where no one says he's autistic, so I'm allowed to laugh. It's a 17-minute video of this 12-year-old boy who really likes SpongeBob trying to cook raw meat in his very nice kitchen, and his parents are just filming and clearly hate him.
Why do they hate him?
Because he's him, and he keeps doing the SpongeBob laugh because he thinks he lives in SpongeBob world. He goes that just sporadically for no reason.
Yeah,
no context at all. He just does it. Anyway, it's a great video.
All right, thanks, honey.
You're welcome.
I'll have to check that out.
Go to that dark room.
Well, thanks for joining us.
Spangle space. Safe space.
Bye, honey.
Bye.
Oh, man. So, it is Harry's birthday. Harry, it's your birthday. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
How old are you?
I turned the ripe old age of 31.
Nice.
Yeah.
So, for your birthday, we got you a kiss from Greg. Go ahead. On the lips.
Is there, like, a receipt for that?
Hashtag no homo.
You want to return it? we're going to let
Harry... Are you going to deport it?
We're going to let Harry... Raise the topic. It's whatever Harry wants to talk about.
Hear, hear.
Whatever is fascinating Harry at this particular moment.
Triggering him.
Listen, I never know half of what you're talking about, and I'm a digital director for a website. But you, when you're on, we have people... Sorry, Emily's putting on deodorant behind you guys.
All right. Sometimes when I get nervous,
it's Old Spice too. It's Mandy.
Got it from a gas station.
She got it at a gas station.
Is it the blue or the green?
Red.
Classic Old Spice.
Oh, I meant like the actual inside, not the container.
It's white.
Oh, wow! Yeah. It's really old school.
So Harry, when Harry is on though, we get letters from people going, "Oh my god, that was so fascinating! I loved every minute of Harry."
Quite the following.
Harry's beloved. Harry will be there Monday
Dr.
night.
Dr. Harry Price.
He will sign your poster. If you want us to autograph your poster and run it, then we'll be happy to. Additional posters for sale for $40. So, Harry.
Yep.
What topic would you like to talk about?
Pressure. I've been reading a lot of cool different things. Like, I've been reading about terrestrial, data. Sending this really cool project was like sending like data through like lasers and stuff like that through up terrestrial up in the outer space, which is really cool. But
the space internet,
yeah. But it gets very, very complicated, very, very fast, and very, very fast, and a lot of hard math. Like, I'm sitting there like drinking and scribbling out math on a cocktail napkin at a bar, having weird people look at me.
You are melting Emily's heart right now,
and the other one. Yes, but it's not. When I was doing that at the bar, that wasn't as bad. When I was sitting there reading the uranium book, that one was bad. That one gave me got me looks at the cigar bar.
Which cigar bar?
It's now Blend, but it was like the cigar bar off of 86th Street by the Keystone Fashion Mall when I did it there. But now,
oh yeah,
Blend.
I know that one. That's a good one. Yeah.
Yep. But because I used to go there. Anyways, the topic I'd like to bring up about is, I don't know if you saw the news about hack team getting hacked. It was a team of white hat hackers who make hacking tools for governments. Like the United States government, Germany, Russia, they make hacking tools for governments to hack political dissidents, and they got hacked. A team of black hacks hacked them.
Now, when you say, now, I've read about companies that do this before, especially there's one that's in Israel that's really famous. Mm-hmm. Now, so is Hack Team a company, or is it just like an anonymous type organization?
It's a company that makes things for, governments.
Okay, and so that's like the name of the corporation, Hack Team?
And they got hit.
Sorry?
Yeah. And they got hit. And so like all those, really, really creepy, like, I remember I came on, I was talking about like the one of the members of the Hack Team was talking about that one type of tool they've got to go into people's like phones, right?
Right.
And he was talking about the tool. As he was talking in that webcam of that video, he had a piece of tape over his camera, okay?
Right.
That team got hacked.
Okay.
So that software is out there. That's why it was so dangerous and so, like, people were so paranoid about Apple creating that backdoor to the Apple encryption.
Because then it's always there and always accessible.
Because once it exists, it touched the internet, it's accessible.
Forever.
If you think about it, like, when people have things touch the internet, it's like it's touching your front door, but the door is unlocked. And any layers of security is just as good as any crappy key lock.
Right.
You know, it really just stops the honest criminal. That's it. Yeah, key locks are like nothing. If you want, I'll bring my lock picking set up and I'll show you how fast I can pick your lock.
See, every time Harry's on, I don't want him to come back because I'm afraid the next time he comes back, it's going to be under nefarious circumstances.
Like when he has your webcam on.
I clearly didn't look. I was sitting out front of your door for 30 minutes and I clearly didn't pick your lock.
Next time you have permission to pick the lock and come.
That would be
just pump, pump, pump.
That would be outstanding.
Snapchat him on his bed.
Honestly, I wouldn't be mad. I'd actually be really. I think that was funny. No, like Harry came on last time and he'd said, "Oh, well, I see you have a drop cam. I'm gonna hack it." It's like, well, then you're gonna be real upset when you see me nude, very nude, because I am nude all the time, right, Emily?
She dad as hell.
She doesn't like the word nude because that's dad as hell, she says. Say naked like a grown up.
Naked.
Naked.
I thought you liked the dad as hell thing.
Yeah.
Oh, I do.
Yeah,
I wasn't criticizing. I just hate the word nude.
Come here. You got to tell them what you wrote when you were 15.
What? Where did
15
I
at camp. 15 at camp.
I didn't go to camp. Why would I go to camp?
She's not Anne Frank.
Oh.
Yeah. So, talk about that.
I'm trying to remember what you're talking about. Oh.
Your parents sent you away.
Yes, I did go to a Bible camp for a brief time.
And under hobbies, you wrote?
Silver foxes.
And
I knew exactly what I meant.
What was she, what was the reception to the 15-year-old Emily saying
nobody
she was
mentioned it. Nobody said a thing. We just turned him in to our Sunday school teacher.
Yeah.
And I never heard anything about it.
Good.
They must have not known
That's funny.
What it meant.
All right, well, you can have good luck with your makeup.
Thanks, I'm putting on eyeliner.
All right, sweet. all right, so Harry, continue. Every time you're on, you said you're going to pick my lock. And yes.
Well, there's
they got hacked.
That's why it was so dangerous for something like that to be exist. If you think about anything touching the internet, it's like something touching your front door. It's just going to stop honest criminals. The most things you can mostly do is put a firewall up. You can tell someone got in, or if you can prevent it, you make it difficult so to make sure someone who gets in is got to be highly skilled.
Right.
You know, which limits the number of people who can get in, and that's really the best you can do. And if you really don't want someone to touch it, you don't give anyone physical access for it. And one of those things is, don't put it on the net. But the problem is, the government it's a hard time for them to get anything like a paid service or make something easy for them to work for the government online. They won't put that online. But everything else, oh, that's online. Why is that database of everyone's social security number online?
Right.
I can't, I have to go through different services to submit my taxes online. But no. But my social security number? Oh, accessible online. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Doesn't Harry scare the shit out of you every time he's on?
Well, it does, but I mean, it's it's a testament to, you know, once information's digital, which we're in the information age.
Yeah.
There's, you know, it's like trying to make water, stop water from running downhill. You know, there is no way to effectively stop it, no matter how big the dam, you know, eventually and in time it breaks through every dam.
And
goes where it wants to, because it finds the path of least resistance.
Technology is going to make government irrelevant. It's a matter of time. We're you know, like, the creation, the beginning of Bitcoin to show that, you know, most people are like, well, if you need government to create, you know, monetary policy, to make money. Well, okay, so cryptographic currency, like, to say, like, okay, we don't need you for that. So you just keep going at it, using technology to finally eliminate government, the necessary need for it.
Right.
You know, you could set up that there and just kind of just start getting away, just like cell 411, making the need, so stopping, so when cops go, like, call a crackhead, fine then, I'll call a crackhead. As long as I've got the crackhead won't kill my dog.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, I don't tend to believe that the government withers away completely. Because, you know, the one thing I'm always stuck on, it's one I've talked with you about before, is the element of the justice and the rogue actor that chooses not to purchase justice as a service provided within whatever environment. And I don't, you know, I don't know that's necessarily a huge problem, because it's probably a very few small group. But I do think that at a certain point, even though everybody's an individual in an atomized society, there can be a collective that forms out of that and throws off the entire balance of the individuals. Do you not see that as do you think it goes completely away, government long-term completely evaporates?
In the eventuality, that is the goal.
Always.
Yeah, it's
the That's the goal. Noble lie we all go, yeah, or, you know, the or goal. The end point you look
now,
for.
Now, like, I feel you. It's one of the things that, like, even my own head, I can't wrap around of trying to figure out how to do without the justice system, without some sort of form of government.
Or a mandate.
Yeah, everything else, like water, sewer, electricity, all this different stuff, it's like, yeah, we've got that. We don't really need the phone lines in the ground and stuff to run, the different stuff like that.
No.
Alexander Graham Bell was able to send, you know, kilobytes of data through the air. You know, that's...
Technology always finds a way.
Yeah, they were able to send wireless communications hundreds of years ago.
Oh, yeah.
So we don't need, and with electric power, there's an easier way to make plants of different power here at different people's houses, or just have different, you know, stations and set up. It's, we eventually try to just use technology or just the advancement of the human race to eliminate the need for the government.
I guess, though, that kind of raises the issue, though, like, especially with the information, is that your personal and private information, you no longer, since government's in control of it, since they're the issuer, or the whatever third party you know trust with it.
Yeah.
It's a world that's completely open, but then completely open to manipulation. What does that look like for, like, so basically your social security number is known by everybody and accessible to anybody at any time. Date of birth, bank account information.
But the thing is, like, how do you steal someone's social security number? It's what is it? 7 digits? You can guess and probably get someone's social security number.
Right.
You guess.
I mean, the important stuff's the bank account information, but, like, that's where Bitcoin, you know, with the ledger.
Correct. But if you want to see how easy it is to take someone's information off of someone's bank, call your own bank. Try to get in your account without giving any hardcore information. Just try to get in your
right.
account.
Right. And the leaks are usually internal.
Yeah.
You know,
you will watch someone who makes, not, you know, $8.25 an hour at that call center. It just will open up your freaking account just because you gave sort of the right answers, and sort of answers you can find about yourself that you have given up on, you know, like on Facebook. Like, you see those questions like, hey, you want to find out your porn name? The street you grew up in with your mom's maiden name.
You know, something that...
There's a honey... not honey pots necessarily in the official word, but they're basically just grabbing your data and then selling your data to third party,
like LimeWire back in the day.
Right.
Kazaa.
And a lot of what's happening, like, we talk about it all the time in various conversations that I have elsewhere. You put a targeting pixel on your website, and then once you hit my website, and then that targeting pixel will follow you everywhere. So let's say you go to a political website, you've hit the Daily Beast. And then you go to other sites and you start seeing in the Google ad boxes, Hillary, 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 Hillary. It's because Hillary went to, you know, an ad server company which feeds ads through a retargeting pixel to the Daily Beast, And then you picked up that cookie on the Daily Beast website, and then that targeting pixel follows you everywhere you go and feeds you those ads.
If you do it right, you could actually get Victoria's Secret models on those ads, so you actually can see boobs when you do that, though. Ooh. You got to do it right.
Okay. Well, more on that. But, yeah, there's a book called Targeted. It's titled Targeted. It's got, like, a pin in the front. It's a white book. Check it out. And it kind of it expands on all the ways that you're being marketed to. Because I'll tell you, as a person who works in digital media, my entire job and hobby is all about digital communication for my mass media job and my hobby here. It's how do I build and engage an audience and then monetize it.
Yeah.
You know, I personally don't want to sell ads. I don't want to...
Well, it depends on, like, you know, but there's nothing inherently wrong with an ad.
No, I'm...
As long as it's relevant and it arrives at the point in the buying cycle where you're looking for that kind of information, it's in fact beneficial.
I'll sell ads for Ice House beer.
I'm a fan of Seth Godin. I don't think you might... But you may or may not be Greg.
No, I like him. I think he gets all the credit for other people that sort of scratch the surface of the ideas. He's just really good at building it into a
like Malcolm Gladwell.
Yeah.
Right. My cousin hated Malcolm Gladwell.
I don't hate it. I just don't think they're the thought leaders everybody else does.
I'm like, well, just because he's good at storytelling, you know, it's like...
Exactly.
Steve Jobs may have taken the idea for the mouse, but you wouldn't have ever known for the mouse if it weren't for the marketer.
Yeah.
So anyways, Harry, continue. Well,
the other thing is, I want to touch on that real quick, is that I like live reads of talk radio when they do their ads. That's my favorite part of talk radio.
Right.
I love that. I love it when they like try to segue into it. I love it when they try to squeeze it into the conversation. That's my favorite part of talk radio.
It's permission-based.
Yeah.
It's something that Seth talks about. It's you know, you're expecting now for us to say, like, go donate to We Are Libertarians. That's how we offset the cost. So we don't really make any money off of this. Like, it's everybody donates their time. I collect the money, and then I just put it right back into Facebook ads or printing the posters or whatever, you know? And because we want to build...
Or meme apps.
Memes. Memes everywhere. So yeah. Have we finished on your topic, Harry? Any other things you'd like to say?
It's a big topic.
Yeah,
there's a lot to discuss on it.
Big thing. Like, one time I was supposed to come on and talk about the whole iPhone issue. Like, I almost wanted to bring it up and say, because since the United States government regulates encryption as an armament,
right?
You know, I was going to try to bring up the whole like encryption issue. It was a Second Amendment issue. What? It's an armament. I have the right to encrypt. You want to regulate encryption as an armament? Awesome. Sweet. It's an arm.
Harry just blew my mind.
Well, because they tried to do it that way, so you couldn't sell like encrypting devices to certain countries like that that we're at war with, because encryption is so bad. Because if they can't read it, then you know.
Right. Yeah. All right, kids. Well, happy birthday, Harry.
Thank you.
We didn't even get to Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is.
Arabia.
Talk briefly, like. Tell people why they should go seek out this story, because we don't have time to cover it. We're at 2 hours already. But.
So, basically, there were 28 pages of the 9/11 report that were never released.
Right.
And Lee Hamilton, a senator from here in Indiana, kind of led the investigation, and they were always outraged at the fact that these were the most critical pages of it, because the rumor's always been that it showed that the Saudi Arabia at the highest levels of government were who planned and carried out the attacks of 9/11. And in a data dump last year, what was recently found was documents like DC-17 or something like that. A guy that's just been hammering away at this actually found that there was an envelope for one of the people that went on to become one of Al-Qaeda's top bomb makers, actually trained and was given a visa to the United States here knowingly, and we allowed him to leave on the day of 9/11. And get out, and we allowed families, Saudi Arabian families, that had ties to get out of Florida, and in neighborhoods where actually Jeb Bush family has a house.
Wasn't that part of Fahrenheit 9/11? Did you ever see that?
Yeah. But the reason it's odd is that, you know, traditionally, if this kind of act happened, you know, if we said the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, go after them. Instead, Saudi Arabia is our biggest regional ally.
Right.
You know, and so. They're the source of all of our information. They're the sort. They own $750 billion worth of our debt. We are heavily reliant on them. And they admitted they created ISIS. You know, they've helped fund ISIS because we toppled Iraq and they needed a power structure in place.
Right.
That was a fundamental Islamic power structure similar to theirs. And this has all come out lately through documentable evidence.
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, you're good. And they found a... So basically, the 28 pages we all know now, like it's confirmed. Saudi Arabian government, various key actors facilitated 9/11 and planned it and carried out the attack. Like, we have the one document we need where we know basically what the 28 pages that are missing say.
Hmm.
I mean, Thomas, these are the 28 pages Thomas Massie read and said it completely changed his perception of the last 10 years of the war on terror. And so it's huge because they're our ally. And what's happened is a bill's been passed. And it's working its way up through the House and Senate called the 9/11 bill. And what it does is it allows citizens of the United States, victims whose family members were killed during the attacks, to sue the Saudi Arabian government.
Wow.
Now, this puts President Obama in a tough position because he ran on getting those 28 pages out there.
Hmm.
Now he's, you know, backtracked.
But it's fraught with peril because they own so much of our treasury bills, right?
They do, but here's the thing. Is the Federal Reserve's the buyer of last resort. So anytime someone dumps our bills, they have to find a buyer. Realistically, we could ask the European Central Bank, or we can ask Russia or somebody else to buy the $750 billion. But the Federal Reserve, no matter what, will always buy United States debt if it's going to be subject to a bank run. So they would buy it. And since the Federal Reserve is at the point they can't do any more quantitative easing or loosening of monetary policy, this would let them buy it and do $750 billion. Have that asset to do more, like, you know, basically more quantitative easing for a fourth round.
Oh, wow.
To stimulate the economy. So it's actually not, like, there's a benefit to the Obama administration to passing it
right
into the Federal Reserve for the Democrats in this election and for the economy, but it also opens up letting Saudi Arabians sue United States for people that have been killed by United States drones.
Oh, wow.
So it really brings a lot of elements into play because it opens up, which is actually what the TPP is. The TPP allows basically a above sovereign country governments above to do like quick, a fast lane for
sure.
Commerce
mm-hmm.
lawsuits outside of domestic law. And this is going to be an issue that comes up as the world comes closer because right now, not everybody's in, you know, the world... in the Hague,
mm-hmm.
you know. And so what happens as countries have an incentive, sort of like we talked about, do they have an incentive to join
mm-hmm.
a justice system or to remain sovereign where they can't be sued?
Right.
They can be the rogue actor.
Mm-hmm.
When
yeah.
you're as big as the United States, there's no reason to ever let other people sue you
right.
and
yeah.
join a system that puts you on an equal playing field with everybody else.
Right.
And
are we part of that system?
To an extent, but we fund everything. So we were able
right.
to influence and get out of things that we're beholden to.
Yep.
You know, I didn't realize till the other day, the National Interest put out that, you know, we've spent $30 trillion building NATO.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Think about that.
Yeah.
That's insane.
$30 trillion building NATO.
Yeah.
And so how much of the treasury bills of Saudi Arabia is that we have to buy back?
Well, $750 billion.
Right.
But like, that's why...
But
that's
$30 trillion that we could have had...
Oh, yeah. Like, we would have no national debt.
Right.
Yeah.
We'd have $12 trillion surplus.
Oh,
and so, I know, like, that's, and this, the reason they wrote the article is that's what the guy was saying is, I don't care for Donald Trump, but I'm so glad someone finally got making other countries pay for their military
yep.
into
right.
the national discussion
mm-hmm.
because we have been getting milked for decades.
Yep.
I mean, we spent $30 trillion.
And they're using that extra slush fund to pay for their socialism.
Right, well, that's why Saudi Arabia, we prop them up, and they're also... President Obama has sold more arms and weapons to Saudi Arabia in his 5 years in office
mm-hmm.
than Bush in 8.
Hmm.
I mean, he has ratcheted up the selling of arms, but also, I mean, through foreign aid, we give them so much money. And, you know, you can make the case, the political winning side of this is damned the political fallout and that kind of, or the legal fallout.
Right.
They killed, you know, the Twin Towers. And we're going to just give them a free pass.
Right.
But whoever seizes on that first, man, they have a home run winning message.
Interesting.
And so it'll be a campaign issue coming forward, because now that they found the one document in a data dump the government tried to hide by putting it in with like over 6 or 10 million other documents and reports, this one guy committed, been on this like a hawk, found the thing that ties it all together.
Right. Cool. Well, I don't know if that's something to watch, and that's really interesting and scary.
It's scary, because then if Saudi Arabia were to fall, like let's say we did regime change there, you hand Mecca and Medina to ISIS.
Yeah.
So it's the damnedest political thing to be stuck. I mean, it's one thing to run on it as a political message, it's an entire another thing to have to deal with it as a real world event.
Or second Texas.
Yeah.
All right, so Harry, it is your birthday. You get to go first as we close out this episode.
All right, one thing I'm going to put out there, the close out there, just to, I'm going to keep saying this, like, if you have that IT person in your family who likes to call you, that you call up to help them work on your computer, do them a favor. Back up your device. Go out there, buy a $75 terabyte external USB 3.0 or Thunderbolt drive, and back up your hard drive. That IT person in your family or friend that works on your computer and gets it back after you got some ransomware after, you know, being on some crappy website all the time, well, thank you, because there's a whole backup of your drive. Please do it. It's $75, and you can use it for, you know, use it forever. Just keep backing it up.
What about like Mosey online backup or one of those cloud-based ones?
You can use cloud-based, but what if you can't get to the internet? It's a good choice.
Then we're all screwed.
You could have
world's over.
Something could be bad. Something could be wrong with your internet connection.
Yeah, you could. Yeah, you have a damaged card.
It could happen. You could be somewhere else. But this way, you could have your backup of your drive on you. You just have it on you, and then you make a backup. Leave it at your mom's. Leave it at home. Have 3 different backups. And trust me, when something goes bad, it's easy just to go like, "Wow, I just pulled this out of the drawer." Like when my drive went bad a few weeks ago. All I did was like, crap, my drive went bad. I lost a few memes that didn't get backed up. I plugged my drive back in Saturday, and I was up and running again. That's it. It was so much easier than trying to, you know, do everything else and trying to restore the drive. And I did finally get those memes I've lost and got restored, but...
There's nothing more infuriating than lost memes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, you know. And granted, cloud backup is nice, but like, what if something happens to that cloud backup service? What if happens if Mosey's servers went down? What would you do? Your stuff is gone. You're gone. Or what if something, you know, something could happen? You know, they could get their company could go down at any time. Same way happened with Microsoft's OneDrive when they was allowing anyone to save all you want on it.
Yeah.
Then they brought that down, and you had like, a couple of months to try to get all that information that you just stored.
Entire meme. Yeah. You had a meme library.
Right.
Yeah. You had that 15 petabyte meme library up there that has to come down.
Man.
It goes somewhere. So it's easier just to have that side little drive up there. I know that's not very political. This is just more of as a tech person to other people who use technology, back up your devices. Back up your
BlackBerry. Get a terabyte high drive. Get on Amazon Prime and get it.
Back up your Android device. Back up your contacts. Back up your photos. Back them up. Also, Also, while you're backing things up, try out Linux. Try it out.
Partition off your operating system and put a new one on there.
Just get rid of your operating system.
Try it out. Get off the
You might like it.
Listen, you're not technologically advanced enough to hook up an external hard drive and back everything up, but, you know, give Linux a try.
Yeah. There's a huge community. And trust me, most of those tech guys are like, hey, you're trying out Linux? Cool, let's go get a beer. Bring that laptop down to the bar. I'll show you how to, like, do things in this thing. What was it in drink beer? Linux and chill.
Where is this universe?
Well, like, I've gone to the bar before and helped people that will mostly, like, start, like, different coffee shops and, like, bars, like, and help people with their Linux. What? This used to be back in the time it was hard to install Linux. Now it's very easy to install Linux on most people's computers. It's easy.
Harry, your swag, man.
Mm-hmm. Your swag is on fire, bro.
It's wicked.
It's just really nerdy stuff.
Most no, it's important.
You're melting my girlfriend's heart over there, too. She just is like... Because Emily loves...
He's an angel.
Yeah, he's an angel, she said. She said she's precious. She just loves this kind of, like... any like, subculture that's nerdy, she's so into it.
I like to hear people talk about things that they are excited about.
She likes to hear people talk about things in which they're excited. You have on your phone a disturbing photo as your background.
I do. It's one you made. And thank you, by the way. If you listen to the Jeff Bimbert podcast, he has an assistant.
An assistant to the host.
An assistant to the host, Caitlin Kopetsky, who is wonderful. Very, very fun girl. But Spangle decided to play, instead of Where's Waldo, Where's Jeff Bimbert. And so he took multiple pictures of Caitlin's face, which the expression can only be described as like a very satisfying fart. Like the kind of fart that like itches a scratch in your butthole.
She had fallen asleep in the car, and Jeff took a photo, and yeah, it looks like an O face.
Yeah, I mean, there is such a sense of relief on that face. But then you hid Jeff in it.
It's my cover photo on Facebook right now. And this is April 21st, 2016. Yeah. So you can go back and look through my cover photos, Chris Spangle. Yeah, and so I multiplied many 100 different Caitlin layers on Photoshop and then hid Jeff in there. And so you can go, if you've got the Monday blues, you can go in there and find Doug.
And if you decide to make it your phone background, which I have, what I've been telling people is it's not actually Caitlin. It's some random girl I met from Tinder. And she made it my phone background, but it's password protected. And that's how she guarantees that she gets a second swipe.
Nice.
And so that's what people will think. She's the crazy Tinder girl that is raping people's phone backgrounds. As far as last thing, if you are coming out to the convention, say hi, even if you hate us. We're not nearly as, our reputations aren't nearly as bad as people would imagine.
We're very delightful.
Yeah, occasionally.
We just don't want to be on our bad side, because we're very effective.
Yeah. Sometimes.
Tactical memes.
And then hopefully I will see you on the 25th for our first live show at Morty's Comedy Joint. And, there was one political thing, but, Paul Ryan's starting to get flack for being shitty.
Really?
Yeah, his ineffectiveness and his willingness to let the Liberty Caucus play a role in the formulation policy has caught a bunch of flack, and there is a ton of Democratic backlash. Right, they're taking the Liberty Caucus and turning it into the Tea Party Caucus all over again, like from a messaging standpoint. Mm-hmm. And so they're saying, you know, they're being held hostage by the Liberty crowd.
Nice.
And Paul Ryan, for the first time, is actually not getting good press. I'm going to be interested to see how he responds.
Yeah. On the 25th, if Emily doesn't work, she's going to be opening for us. So she's going to do a little comedy set, just to give you a little, a tight five.
Mm-hmm.
A tight five, tight seven, just to warm the crowd up. Jeff Bimbert, Caitlin Kopetsky will be introducing us.
Will they really?
Yeah, I haven't talked to you about this, but I just figured, like, you go to a show, like, you got to have a little bit of a warm-up, because you got to have a little presentation.
We can't cold open.
Right, and Emily will hopefully do a little opening. Jeff and Caitlin.
Very funny.
Very funny. Good friends of ours. They're going to be roasting Greg and I a little bit, and they're going to introduce us onto stage, so come and see Jeff. Greg and I get made fun of by Jeff and Caitlin. And you're going to get a poster, you're going to get games, you're going to meet all the We Are Libertarian stars.
Chris and I have an 83-slide presentation of memes that we plan to show.
And so all it costs is $5, show up, get some food, get some drinks.
Throw tomatoes at us.
Right, and Maya. Maya will be there.
Nice, I look forward to seeing her.
So you can meet Maya.
I know Maya.
You don't think Maya's going to show, Harry?
If she does, she's going to be late.
Well, it takes a long time to put all that makeup on. All right, kids, thank you for joining us here on We Are Libertarians. That wasn't
happy,
a shot.
Happy birthday, Harry.
Happy birthday, Harry.
Yes. So, if you see Harry, wish him a belated happy birthday.
So, thanks for joining us here on this episode of We Are Libertarians. We'll talk to you in just a few days. Maybe we'll have something posted before the live show. If not, we'll see you on Monday night. We're very much looking forward to it. Brett Bittner, what did we call Brett Bittner?
Little Brett Bittner?
Yeah, what was Brett? He was...
Oh,
unkempt dad.
Unkempt political dad.
That's it.
Unkempt political dad, Brett Bittner. And as always, we promise...
to do better next time. All right.
Ooh.
Dad as hell.
That's very funny.
You are dad as hell.
Yes.
Oh, that really should be in your bio on Facebook.
That should just be your bio.
That really should. Twitter, Instagram.
Dad as hell.
Dad as hell. LinkedIn.
Dad as hell. Yeah. Certified dad as hell.
Dad as hell.
I'm going to use the volume and hold it.
Is it open mic night or is it your set to perform?
Open mic.
Is it open?
Oh. 10 at 10 is an open mic, but it's like pre-made like lists of people.
Oh, so you don't have to just like sit and wait?
Yeah.
Is there anyone good going besides you?
I actually don't know.